Hello, lovely people. Welcome back to the Distinct and Jovial podcast. My name is Dom, and I'm joined by my wonderful co-founder, Jerry. How are you doing, Jerry?
Dom, my friend, my co-founder, love you. Yes, I'm good, thank you. How are you?
Yeah, very, very good. Very good now that we're here, I think is probably the best thing, isn't it? We're stressed, but we're here, and this is the good bit in life.
Yes, and actually, just to explain, because this is not going to go in the podcast, obviously, but we have recorded a pre-podcast chat just to check in on one another and make sure that we're okay, because we're not actually really okay, but we are okay. We're okay now, but it's, life is tough.
But yeah. And we're 14 minutes into a recording, so that just proves how long we've been.
Yeah, exactly.
It's not as bad as when we were with Pistol Pete, where we were recording for an hour.
Yeah, I can't believe we were on the... Was that an hour? We were on the...
It was about an... I didn't hit record straight away, but we were talking with Pistol for about an hour.
Bloody hell.
And that's when I've written down a lot of the conversation in terms of note form, because I'm like, can we come back to that and talk about that on the podcast in a future episode?
Yeah, I'm dying to get him back. Pistol, you're probably listening to this, so thinking of you, say hi. Oh,
what a legend.
He is a legend.
Absolute legend. Normal kind of like spiel to make sure that we don't get fined or fired or anything in between, which is important now, as we'll go into. It's the 28th of January, operationlastminute.com, straight in there. That's what are we going to do? It's just January. We're on the 107th day of January, trying to make £3.18 last until the end of the month.
We got paid what feels like 12 months ago.
It does feel like that. Yeah. This is episode number... Do you know what? I got really confused because I mixed a few episodes. I think this is episode 32. But it might be episode 33. Okay. I don't know. I may have made a mistake on the sheet. I've done a wrong burgundy. Right.
It's always good if you've done that many podcasts that you lose count. That's a good sign.
Yeah. I think I said on the last podcast it was episode 32, and then I uploaded it to YouTube and went, well, the last podcast I uploaded was episode 30, so this must be 31.
So not 32. Or 33.
So I think this is 32.
Oh, this is 32.
I could check, actually. I've got the channel open. What am I doing? Idiot, Dom. Check it. Content. So the last episode was... Oh, no, the last episode was 32.
So this is 33.
Although I think I've labelled that wrong because the episode before was 31. Hang on a minute. Talk amongst yourselves here, people. So we've got Keanu Reeves, Vanity Fair number one. So we got 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 with the wonderful Swanee, 10. So which was one of our Matrix theory.
Oh yeah.
Then we had our bonus one. So that was our first. So our 11th episode. So, which was our bonus podcast, was...
So you're counting that?
Labeled as a bonus. So that's okay. Not counted. Then we've got Snack Wars and Death Battle, which is 11, 12. Oh my God, Amber Heard versus Johnny Depp was podcast number 12.
No, we've really?
Done, yeah, then we've got...
That feels like it was yesterday.
13, 14, 15. Our first episode with Hoops was 15. 16, 17, 18, 19 was the first podcast with Evgeny. 20, wow. 21, 22, 23, 24, 25. If anyone's wondering, I'm not actually counting. I'm looking at the titles and making sure that they all match. 26, 27, second episode with Evgeny. 28 with Steve. 29 was my retirement podcast. Episode 30 was with a dungeon master. And episode 31, which I have labeled incorrectly. So while I'm here, I'm going to edit that.
Nice.
31, save.
File, rename.
Which is they're taking the hobbits to Isengard. Because that was our Samwise episode. So there we go. So this is episode 32, officially.
Nice.
Officially episode number 32. So yeah, as always, our views are our own and they don't represent the companies, anybody else. And I have a message for you, Jerry.
Oh,
which I'm now going to... Well, it's for both of us, but I'm going to read out this message.
Okay.
I've got my phone here. We apparently, according to the legend, and we know who the legend is, don't we, Jerry?
There's only one.
We missed the most famous of all time in our discussion with Pistol. If you remember, Stop the Pigeon from The Wacky Races. And I then asked if this was from the most recent one, because that was only message, that was message halfway through January, and she said no, that was with Pistol. So she's now part, she said, I'm now part way through the Samwise one. Samwise is a very sensible girl bringing a large glass of wine with her to cope with you two. And then, but please don't you or Jerry bring alcohol, or the podcast could disintegrate very rapidly. And my response, you're assuming that the podcast actually currently holds together without alcohol. I think that is a wrong assumption.
I think she's giving us more credit than we deserve.
Yeah. This is the message. This much is true. However, if it is alcohol fueled, then maybe that should be clear. Then I don't feel responsibility for anything you say or do. Maybe you should incorporate that into your denials, i.e. views are all yours and do not reflect how you were brought up.
Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. So if we do a drinking episode, you need to do that disclaimer.
Well, I think I need to do the disclaimer that my mother wants me to really, the legend, my mother, really wants me to emphasize that the views are my own views and don't represent how she's brought me up, regardless of whether I'm on alcohol or not.
Really? Even now? Yeah. Stone cold sober? Yes. On a Sunday morning? Bloody hell. Okay. Wow. Wow.
So, yes.
Okay.
That was the message from my mother that she wanted. Views are not connected to our upbringing. So my mother is distanced herself from all of my views. To be fair to her, she does agree with, I'd say, about 80% of the views that I hold in terms of, like, that's Muppets.
Not, that's not a bad rate.
People.
That's not a bad hit
and the
rate.
Things that we... I know. And the things that we do disagree on, you know, they're usually generational upbringing bits and pieces. But that's all fine. Like, I love her to pieces, and I'm sure that she loves me to pieces regardless of what my opinion is.
Look, the fact that she even wants you to put that disclaimer in, sober, that just reinforces why she's a legend.
Exactly. So, yeah, my mother is encouraging me to...
drink.
What's the phrase? Encouraging me to drink. That, honestly, an alcohol-fueled podcast, I do not think would go well for us.
I think it'd be hilarious.
I don't drink very often, so... Well,
I do drink often, but I can't hold my liquor very well.
Mm.
So I think it would be hilarious. Just maybe... Look,
it would go.
I'm just throwing it out there. Maybe an idea for a future podcast. Where we go?
Well, we got plenty of episodes of future podcasts to do, isn't it?
Exactly.
It's not going to stop anytime soon.
Well, have you ever seen Drunk Histories?
Yeah. No, I haven't.
Oh, so funny! They get comedians and they ply them with drink a lot of drink.
I might have seen clips of it. I didn't know it was called Drunk Histories.
Yeah, Drunk Histories. So they narrate interesting facts from history. And then they get, but they do it whilst drunk. So they it's hilarious. And then they have actors and actresses that then lip sync and act out everything that they're talking through. Dom, it is honestly, it's so ridiculous, but what a genius concept. And it is so funny. The one with Shakespeare is my favorite.
Okay. I'll have to look that up when we get to the other bits. Like, it's going to be like, I'm just literally putting heading three, like, post podcast.
Get drunk.
Yeah. List. Get drunk. No, it's Drunken Histories. And you said the Shakespeare one is your favorite.
Oh, Shakespeare one is hilarious. I've forgotten the comedian's name. But yeah. I can't even say anything. I can't even. I'm not going to even give away any spoilers. Just watch that. And then...
Just watch it.
Just watch that and watch some other episodes as well. They're fantastic. Yeah. But they do have a lot of drink. I'm talking like some of these comedians, like 8 pints of lager and then 2 shots and glass of wine.
I don't think I drank 8 pints of lager in my life.
I couldn't drink 8 pints of water. I have had Well, I have had 9 pints before.
And what, beer?
Yeah, over the course of a day, and that did not end well. When I got,
there's the two problems I'd have with alcohol, right? With that amount of alcohol, is A, I would probably be asleep and on the floor, but B, you've got a lot of liquid to get rid of. You would spend half your time in the flipping bathroom.
Yeah, half the time I was in the bathroom. And then towards the end, I didn't make it to the bathroom. It did not end well. That's all I'm going to say.
No, absolutely not. That's why I don't drink very often. That's why I don't drink very often. It's funny, like, you know, Samwise was sort of saying... you know, being in Germany, she lives through like Oktoberfest and bits and pieces like that. And God, I think, that'd be really interesting. But I just, like, the amount of alcohol, just, no. Oh,
and
just,
German lager is so good, but it's strong as well. It's a little bit stronger. It's stronger, so
it doesn't come in pints, it comes in litres.
Steins. Yeah, it's crazy. Yeah.
And you see all the videos of them carrying, like, the giant, like 26 of the things, and they're all like this.
Love it.
Walking along.
Love it.
It's so good. So good. We've got a bit of a mixed bag, I think, for a podcast today, haven't we?
We do. It's a bit of a medley. If I had to describe this, if I had to liken this to anything, I'd say it's like, you know, you have the everything drawer. Everybody's got an everything drawer. You open it up and you go, got some old Euros. Some batteries.
There's always batteries, and they're all dead.
Well, or they work, but you know, one of them, you have like one Duracell and one Eveready.
Other battery brands are available.
Yeah, and you'll be like, "What?" And just old nail file, rubber bands. Got to have rubber bands. Some paper clips. Yes, the junk drawer. So I would liken this. Yeah. This is like an everything drawer episode.
Where is your everything drawer in your house?
It's in the kitchen.
Okay, that's interesting.
Yeah.
Because my parents' everything drawer in the old house was the bottom drawer in the telephone table in the hallway.
That's a strong place to have an everything drawer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because it was where all the old mobiles were stored, or where all the, you know, the batteries were stored. That's all the cables that you would go, I don't know why. I don't think it's... It's not something I've inherited here, because I'm a very much a minimalist, but there'd be a phone charger.
Yeah.
And my parents would go, no, we best keep that in case that comes in useful. For what? You don't have the phone of it anymore.
No.
It makes no sense.
The good thing is, what you're supposed to do, so everything drawer etiquette is that you keep that long enough till eventually you open the drawer and go, what the hell was this charger for? You go, I don't know. Is it a phone charger? I don't know. Which has happened. I found chargers.
You can't get rid of it.
Well.
Because you now don't know what it is for, and it might be for something useful.
I took a punt. I went to the tip last week and took a charger with me that was for something, but I don't know what. And I thought, well, I'm getting rid of it. If it's important enough, I'll have to just get one on eBay if I suddenly discover I'm missing a charger. But I couldn't work it out. It's like, what the hell is this? Just took it to the tip.
Yeah. That's my attitude with things.
Yeah.
And I'm very glad that my parents are grown out of the keep everything attitude.
You do reach that point eventually. It's good that you're already there, Dom. I've been really bad. I've always kept things. So I've always been just in case. And now I'm just like, no, I need to get rid of everything. Get rid of it. Don't need it.
Yeah. I think that might be the OCD bit, because for me, one of the triggers for my OCD is feeling claustrophobic.
Right.
So, like, if a drawer is too full, like, it's like having a sixth sense. I know that drawer is too full. I've been in the drawer and it's too full, so I need to rearrange it. So I tend to get rid of things quite frequently. Well, that took a little bit of a darker turn than I thought it was going to. But, you know, like I said, I've got the OCD under control. But that's one of the things. So I try and get rid of stuff as much as possible. Like, if I could... If I could, you know, almost downsize from my current flat, which is not really possible when you live in a 25 square foot flat, but 25 meter squared flat, I should say. 25 square foot is not big at all.
25 foot. I know. I was like, what? You're living in a lift.
I'm 6 foot. So yeah, I would try and downsize and things like that, but there are certain things you can't, like, you've got to have a certain amount of shoes. And I have, you know, and it's not like, how to phrase it, it's not like I have loads of shoes, but they all have a purpose. So I have my running shoes, my flip-flops, my welly boots, my walking boots, my gym shoes. That's 5 pairs there. My slippers, 6. There you go.
Your heels for when you go out. By the way, can I just say, I've noticed
I don't think
something.
I need to wear heels.
No, that's true. Look, we're both wearing yellow underneath.
Mine's like really...
Yours is like proper yellow. Mine's a faded... Mine's like faded yellow, but it's yellow.
But we're both merched up today.
We are merched up. In fact, we're wearing the same...
For audio listeners, we're in the same hoodie.
Same hoodie and a yellow t-shirt underneath. Great minds, Dom. We didn't even plan this.
Not even planned. But it is a hodgepodge of a podcast today.
It is.
I suppose, actually, we can also say... Can we still say it? I know it's the 28th of January, but can we still say Happy New Year?
Yeah. Cut-off point for me is 30th of June, and I'm keeping a spreadsheet of all the people that I'm saying Happy New Year to, and I'm tracking it. So I'm about 40% of the way through, but I tick it off as I go through. Yeah, I think so.
That's pretty good.
It's worth it just to see people's reactions. Like if you see somebody for the first time in May, or you speak to them for the first time in May, and you go, oh, by the way, Happy New Year, and you think of that.
What the fringe?
What? You go, there you go. And then I just open up my spreadsheet, go down to the name. Have I said hello and Happy New Year to this person? Yes. Tick.
I don't know enough people to do that.
Yeah, neither do I.
Well, that's probably why you've got to speak and do it in the spreadsheet.
I'm just trying to make out I've got loads of friends. There's about 4 lines on the spreadsheet.
Yeah. And after the week I've had with spreadsheets, I don't want to ever see spreadsheets again.
No, I used to hate spreadsheets. I quite like them now.
I hate them after I had to have 7 open on Thursday. Oh. So.
Exactly. Yeah, spreadsheet overload. It's like eating. Yeah. It's like eating so much curry. I love curry, but I couldn't eat 7 curries in a row at the same time.
Your kilo of mini eggs.
Oh, that's gone. That went.
Oh, is it gone?
No, well, I'm not even joking. It went not even last week, but the week before. It didn't even make it to that weekend. Gone. 1 kilo of mini eggs gone. It's bad. I've got to.
I do like
take
mini
it
eggs.
Easy. I do love mini eggs.
Well, with it being a I've completely skipped ahead. So, with it being a new year, in this new year, we set up for the Distinct and Jovial podcast shorts to be uploaded in every day on the YouTube channel and on our Instagram page. If you don't follow us, please do. Instagram pages, you know, whatever, but the YouTube obviously is where we post the video podcast, so you get to see mine and Jerry's lovely faces. But through that, we've had, I've got the analytics up in front. So, and it's really perfect timing because the default for YouTube is 28 days to show on the analytics, and it is the 28th of January. So it is bang on the 28 days to just get all of the stats for January that so far. So your channel in the last 28 days has gotten 13,056 views.
Bloody hell.
12.7K views more than normal. So 12,700 views more than normal.
Right.
And the watch time was 98.1 hours with 78.1 more than usual. And we have gained 10 subscribers in the last month. Right? And that, your question is why and how?
Yeah, that was, I think, later on. Did I put it later on? Did I put it here? Oh, yeah, no. It was in this section. Yeah, I want to know where all the new subscribers are from. That's amazing.
And I mean, like, neither have set out to do it, but it's produced an interesting conundrum because the shorts, there are now 5 shorts with over 2,500 views. Right? They just seem to be, either I've titled them correctly, I'd like to point, I put them on the thing, so I've done a bit of clickbait. I've titled them correctly, and people have commented on them, and things like that, and they've just gone whew, like that. I mean, when you put Brexit in, and when you put Malafors was one that went really high, which I didn't expect, because we were both like, well, can't remember what a Malafor is. The napping chair, well, that's one, and... Apparently, people are really offended about mashed potato being the best form of potatoes. So, Pistol Pete your opinion there was not very warm. So I thought, you don't get to see the comments.
No.
But I do, because I'm the admin of the channel. So I thought it'd be interesting just to go through all our comments that we've got. Of which there aren't hundreds. There's probably about 10 or 15. And some will rattle through quite quickly. And some are silly, that might make us laugh, might give us offensive. Some are a little bit political, but I think it's be interesting to just go through these and go from that. So, yeah. Are you ready for this one?
Yeah, I think so.
I'm not going to share my screen because...
No, don't worry. That's fine.
Riverside this morning, which is the application that we use, which have been really good. They are quite expensive, but for some reason they've had some server issues. So fingers crossed, we're trying not to, try to do everything not
it's
to
not
crack
the boat. Yeah.
So, I mean, so the first comment that we have was from 2 years ago, which was from the wonderful Yevgeny. And we hope we're all doing well. And your merch is on the way, I promise you.
It's weeks and weeks and weeks ago.
It was sent months ago.
It's crazy.
It's sat in customs. And unfortunately, I've got to wait till the 6th of February before I can actually go and say, what the fringe, Royal Mail? But he, on our second podcast, so this is over 2 years ago, put a load of Netflix suggestions. I can't remember if you've got Netflix,
yeah,
Jerry.
Yeah, I do. Mm.
So it's got Dark, Behind Her Eyes, Ozark, Unorthodox, The Good Place, Lost in Space, Sex Education, Stranger Things, which I do, I'm going to put in a controversial opinion in a minute, The Umbrella Academy, Love, Death, Robots, The Queen's Gambit, which was amazing.
It was.
Love and Monsters and The One. So I've only seen two of those, or two and a half, I'm going to say. So I saw The Queen's Gambit, which I really enjoyed.
I loved that. It was surprisingly good, wasn't it? It was amazing.
Yeah, absolutely. The weird thing now is there's a lot of people that now play chess, I think, because of The Queen's Gambit.
Well, they sold out of chess sets, didn't they, for months and months after that was released, and everybody suddenly had a hard-on for chess because of that show.
What's interesting is some people still play it. So when I used to go away on squad trips and stuff like that, they'd take a chess board.
Oh, I love chess.
All the things that you...
No, I love chess.
All the things, I know, but you'd be sat in a hotel lobby and they'd have a chess set out.
Yeah.
And you think... But these are a bunch of like 18-year-olds. I was like, I expect them to be on their phone or drinking. No, they're playing chess.
Good on them.
Good on them. The other one is Stranger Things, which I think is overrated.
So the first season I thought was fantastic, and then it just went downhill.
Yeah. The only thing I really got on board with was Justice for Babs.
Justice for Babs. No,
I thought
it was groundbreaking concept, wasn't it? Really.
Yeah, first season was great. Second season was dreadful.
It was awful. It's just awful.
I think so. I thought it was overrated. Stop saying Other comments we've got. So we have a couple from who I refer to as the perfect human being. And she's just like positive comments. So then we got onto the one with Yevgeny, which had three comments. So we got one from the infamous Shrimp fan himself, Socks. This is a year ago.
Yeah. Keep it shrimp.
And he's just put a comment that says, I will now blow Jerry's mind. People are now starting to have kiwi on pizza as if pineapple wasn't bad enough.
This is why he's shrimply the best.
You're going to get a lot of abuse from Samwise, I think, for that pun. She loves a good pun. But yes, kiwi on pizza.
I don't think it even deserves a comment. My expression says it all.
Yeah. Oh, dear. Then we've got the second comment on this. I'm not sure I can do, but one of my best friends, dads, who actually has one of some of the Ukrainian refugees in his house. And this is a long comment, but I'm going to read it all out. Amazing podcast. Great to hear firsthand from Yevgeny just what it is like in Ukraine since the attempted Russian invasion. His daughter may have mentioned that I've been hosting Ukrainian refugees since the Homes for Ukraine scheme started. I have a 34-year-old lady and her nearly 3-year-old daughter here now. It is immensely rewarding but hard work. The paperwork is mind-boggling and constantly trying to keep their spirits up while effectively having having it so easy myself. The lady that's with her is missing home and family dreadfully and is still very lonely and desperate to return home as soon as it is safe. To think that I spent 13 years in the military being prepared to defend the country and was never called on to fight, and now Ukraine is defending itself against the same regime we were defending against, just brings home how fragile peace can be, which I thought was a wonderful comment. Wow. I said not all of these were comedy, but some of these are really, really nice. And obviously I've redacted a few of the names, but you can go onto our podcast and read that. So yeah,
wow,
great comment. That's very sober. And really puts it into perspective.
Yeah, it does.
Then we have we have one comment on this one and one comment on another podcast by someone that we both know.
Okay.
She's Australian and a lot of Barrel of Laughs.
Oh yeah, okay.
Yeah,
yep.
You're with me.
Yep.
So both of them, just big thank yous for doing that, bringing stuff forward. So the one on Yevgeny is, thank you guys, this was poignant, and this lady is very dyslexic, so I'm having to translate a little bit. And a reminder that we need to keep the invasion in front, forefront of our minds, as I agree the news can bury the important news under trivial topics. I did find the exploding fish tank interesting, which must have been around the time that they had that giant fish tank in the hotel lobby. Germany.
Yes, that's
right. and it exploded and all the fish died.
Oh my god, I forgot about that.
Yevgeny, you bring it home what you and your country folks are going through, and my heart goes out to you all. Dom and Jerry, only second podcast I have ever listened to. Keep them going, as a joy to listen.
Wow.
And then the other one, which is a bit more comedy, so she said, thank you for making the last 2 hours of menial tasks in the kitchen fly by. laughed out loud a lot and agree with Jerry on all of the last points. So this was on The Simpsons Keep Predicting the Future, so I'll have to remember, can't remember what the last points were, but evidently you were correct in something.
Doesn't happen often, so we need to capture that and frame it.
It's written down. I've got some evidence. This comment,
no, don't do it.
But apparently we missed two opportunities in this chat to practice chucking a Yui.
Chucking a Yui.
So, yes. There we go. Nice. And then we're now on to some more recent ones. Oh, we need to get Chuck a Yui in there at some point, don't we?
We do.
More recent podcasts and from Hoops. The first one was, I put out a short that is, what is our most viewed podcast? And he was like, oh, I didn't make the rankings.
He sounds bitter. I'm detecting a hint of sour grapes.
Yeah. is that a food pun?
Possibly. I'm just trying to raise an awareness.
Oh, get out.
Sorry. There's no need to whine about
next
it.
Should be talking, next you'll be talking about current events.
Very good. Very good. We're on point this morning. We are on point.
We have to be. Like, look at us. I did reply to this one. He is up there, by the way. He's not in the top three, but I think he's fourth. So,
come on, yes, that's not bad.
Although, actually, he might have dropped down because I think the legend that is Chat Stevie T has definitely ousted him. but he's now ousting you, Mr. Hooper. Jerry hosting this. Who would knew the day would come? So we may have to get you a bit more hosty.
Oh, really? Mightn't we? I don't know.
Yeah. And less than 2 minutes and we talk about Stonehenge. Which was his rumour one.
Yeah, that's true.
Oh, dear. Then we've got some... This is where the recent comments in, and we start getting to people that we don't know. But we've got a couple that we do. So we have the one from the wonderful Fiona. We need to try... ginger and lemon kombucha, I think it is, K-O-M-B-U-C-H-A, in gin. So we were talking about alcohol early on.
I have no idea what that is. I'm going to have to Google it.
No.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. But apparently it's a game changer. I'm not a big gin drinker.
I love gin. So Fiona, I'm definitely going to try that.
She hasn't put what flavour gin to have.
I'm assuming it'll be just go London Dry, because you're already then flavouring it with something, aren't you? So,
I suppose, yeah. Okay.
Cool.
Another one from Hoops, commenting on the pineapple and pizza gang is growing to Samwise's. Samwise's one. You're being ridiculed in these comments, Jerry, and only I can see them. It's great.
Unbelievable.
Unbelievable.
It is unbelievable, because I really thought that would just be a no-brainer. It's like, yeah, who the hell eats? Does that might only, I don't know, maybe one in a million people eat pineapple on pizza, but clearly that's not the case. Clearly there's a big movement. It's like the flat earthers.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh. Let's not go into that. And then we get, I've got a few comments here, which I'm going to read fairly quickly, because I'm realizing this has taken way longer than I thought. Maybe I shouldn't have done all of it.
It's fine. I like this. Well, we can keep the other bit shorter. It's fine.
Yeah. Look at us planning the podcast on the fly while we're doing it. We have this plan. As in, we wrote the notes last night.
I looked at about 10 o'clock at night. Hashtag to say.
I wrote them Friday. Today's Sunday. So we've got a couple of comments on a short, which is mashed potato is the best, which is what Pistol let in. And somebody has written, fair enough, but I prefer Herbie crispy roast potatoes over mashed potatoes, which I think we both can agree.
Definitely. Definitely.
Somebody else has just written red flag.
Red flag? Why? What?
Are you aware of red flag, green flag?
No, I thought like red flag is in warning red flag. No.
Yeah. So warning red flag. So red flags are usually warnings to sort of say, don't date this person. That's a red flag.
Oh, I see. Thing.
So somebody's going, this is Pete. He's got a big red flag. He likes mashed potato.
Wow. People are more passionate about this than they are about pineapple on pizza.
Yeah.
Okay.
Red flag. I don't know who this is, but their YouTube name, I'm going to read out their YouTube name, is Scott Plug 78, but they must know us, because on Chat Stevie T's podcast they've written, we're waiting on you, hashtag be more Jerry. And I think we've only mentioned be more Jerry in a quiz.
I think I know who that is.
Do you?
I do.
I haven't got Stevie.
I'm just going to say the letters, initials. It's not giving anything away, is it, if I say the initials?
I mean, we can discuss it afterwards.
Yeah, let's discuss it after. I think I know who that is.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Interesting.
So I think it's the same person that left it's a bit of a spoiler alert, but left a very, very kind, a really heartwarming comment about the Winchester, the when Chat Stevie T and I said that we're going to step back from hosting the Winchester.
Okay.
I think it's the same person, if I had to hazard a guess.
So this is either, so I'm going to say the initials. This is either an SH or a BH.
So I'm thinking the latter.
So BH.
Yeah.
It could be.
I think it is. And I think the clue's in the title.
Out. Yeah.
In the name. Is,
shout out him.
Yeah.
Shout out him.
Because I did reply to his message and said, I was genuinely really touched by that. Really, that it was such an amazing.
We could be wrong.
We could be wrong. Yeah, we could be wrong. And then whoever the person listening to this will go, "No, you idiots! That's me."
Do that. It's like me. Do that. Like, tell us we're idiots. Yeah. We love it. We love it. Then we've got one on the Dungeons and Dragons introduction short, and I am going to give this person a shout out because I know him very well. So it's a young lad called called Ben, and he does taekwondo with Adam Swanee. So Swanee's his instructor, and his family are the nicest family I have ever met in my life. Collectively, they are wonderful, 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 wonderful human beings. I absolutely adore them. And yeah, he is an absolute legend. He's just so passionate about things, and you know, everything is just, yeah, oh, I can't put into words how much of a legend he is. And he's really nice. He's such a nice guy. Like, he went off to uni for a bit and we didn't see him around in the taekwondo circuit, and he comes back and it's as if nothing has changed. He's just incredible. The same person. But yes, absolutely love the imagination aspect of it. You as a group of friends can be as serious or ludicrous as you like. Great fun. So evidently a Dungeons and Dragons player.
Nice.
So yeah. And then the wonderful Fiona has commented on Samwise's podcast. Super enjoyable as ever, but apparently I need an intervention because that was when I did my crazy poignant questions.
No comment.
So all of the comments now are people that we definitely don't know. Okay. These are the ones where they've gone viral. So the Malaforce one, the first comment was, those headphones are massive.
Actually, both our headphones are bigger. I think yours are bigger.
Mine are massive. Yeah. I've got some proper Princess Leia headphones here.
Yeah, you have. Definitely.
And somebody has replied to that. The fact that this is the only comment is brilliant.
Oh. We're getting roasted here. It's fine. I love it.
Getting absolutely roasted. The second comment on this Malaforce one was, have either of you seen the Boondock Saints?
No.
It's a film. I've looked it up, but have you seen
it? No. I've heard of it, but not seen it.
No, so it's very entertaining, but the reason I bring it up, there's an Irish bartender in it who has Tourette's, and a result of one of the effects of it is he accidentally mixes metaphors up like this as part of his Tourette's. Okay. So, interesting. Maybe one for us to add to the watch list. Yeah. And we're doing, spoiler alert, we are looking at doing a movie review-based podcast at some point.
Nice.
And then this comment, which I nearly deleted, it just says, the guy on top looks easy to draw. And the guy on top was me.
Easy to draw.
And I was like, is this a compliment?
Easy to draw.
Oh, dear.
I wonder if he created a weemy of you.
Well, it made me chuckle. I was like, I don't know whether to take that as an insult or a compliment, but I suppose whatever.
It's a troll. As random as that.
Absolutely shredded there. And I think the other three comments that we've got, I'm gonna highlight that these are on the short that's called the Consequences of Brexit.
Okay.
So these are all very politically motivated. So it's going to be a complete change in thing. So someone has put, British history is a long and storied rebuttal of the notion that there is such a thing as someone who is 100% British. Which I thought, I mean, that's to a certain extent fair.
Yeah.
I can't really argue with that one. I have no idea about my heritage. And I'm pretty sure there's probably something different in there, but you never know. Maybe I am the one 100% British man. I don't
know. So, I know. Maybe. I think if you did a DNA test on me, I'd probably be about 1% Chihuahua.
Yeah. Yeah.
Chihuahua.
Oh, dear. And then the other two comments, I haven't responded to them because one of them I thought, nice, okay, that's probably going to not get deleted, but it just highlights what I refer to as the incompetence of Americans, because his handle is America268. So okay. He feels very right. And he says, I see they have the same liberal snowflakes over in Britain claiming that everyone is an immigrant, just like Black Lives Matter and every other stupid thing that they say that's obvious, just so they sound like they're right. And I can't quite figure out his comment on what it means and who he's attacking and who he's not attacking. But he doesn't come across great in the comment.
It sounds like he's attacking everybody apart from who doesn't agree with his own views, which probably I'd say sit right of center. I would hazard a guess.
I do. I would say I'm definitely a bit more liberal in my viewpoints, but I get that people have different viewpoints, but it's an opinion and everybody has opinion. They're like belly buttons.
Well, they are. And his belly button's got fluff. And I'll just say, dude, live and let live, bro.
Yeah.
Live and let live.
Exactly. And then the other one was, the reason Brexit isn't golden is political incompetence. Sincerely, a Norwegian lefty. Which is an interesting stance to take, because Norway is not in the European Union, from memory.
No, I don't think it is. I think they... Were they thinking about it, or did they have a vote on it? I can't remember.
I'm just Googling it.
Norway. Interesting.
Iceland, Liechtenstein, Norway, and Switzerland are in the Schengen area. I can never pronounce that. S-C-H-E-N-G-E-N. But are not EU member states.
Okay.
So they get... So basically... The Norway-European relations, because it is associated in the EEA, which is the European Economic Area, which does that now include us? Who is part of that? No. So that's what Brexit did. Interesting. So Brexit didn't just remove us from the EU, it also removed us from the EEA, the... European Economic Area, which is why we're getting absolutely roasted.
So we didn't just go out, we went out.
Yeah. We weren't even 50% in. Bloody like hell. That. So,
okay.
So I'm just trying to look at the colors. Yeah, so Norway is part of the EEA, but it's not part of the European Union. So it's an interesting comment that they've made, because they obviously are a little bit more liberal in their views, even though they live in Norway, which is not part of the European Union. And it's that to me is one of the interesting things about Brexit, is that it was a massive hard exit rather than a kind of actually, could we do something like what Switzerland and Norway do and be part of the economic area, but not part of that. Because, there's going to be little things in the next 2 years, we've got to have visas to travel to Europe. We've got to have, which is going to, it's painful. And all the other bit things that are just currently going on around. That have recently
and we did all of that for what? So. For what? What a I can't. I'm starting to get wound up.
We can't get started.
No, we can't get started on that. Yeah,
yeah. Okay. We voted for it. We're kind of dealing with the consequences, whether we agree with it or not. So, would I love to be returned back in and go back to the way it was? Yes, because my travel would be much easier. I think the trade would be much easier, etc. And we're just. As things expire, that's as we're going to start to feel the burn, as it was.
Yeah,
those are the comments that have been left on our YouTube channel.
Brexit is like one of those really hot chilies. You take a bite, and for the first sort of 10 seconds, you think, actually, that wasn't too bad. And then, just when you think you're getting over it, then it kicks in. I think we're in phase two.
But also, at some point, it's got to come out the other end.
Yeah, that's very
true. So it's going to get even worse then.
That's very
true.
So, yeah. Put the toilet paper in the fridge, ladies and gentlemen.
I don't know how to do that. I don't have to take that as a Oh dear, we're terrible humans.
That's when you to coin one of my favourite expressions of all time, because generally you try to avoid it, but I think that's one of the few times that you would welcome Neptune's kiss.
Yeah. Oh dear.
Because normally you always try to avoid Neptune's kiss. In that instance, you definitely
absolutely
would want it.
Would you though? Because if you drink water, doesn't that make chili worse? When you drink water, it makes chili worse. You're supposed to drink dairy.
You're supposed to drink dairy.
So let's not go there.
Ice cream.
Let's kill this company.
And actually, rice or bread. Eat rice or bread.
Yeah, I suppose. Yeah,
it helps to temper it. But dairy is the best thing you can have. So yogurt, milk,
ice cream, clotted cream.
Yeah, single cream, double cream.
I got absolutely roasted, by the way, for my.
Oh my god! What the hell?
Section of last podcast.
What the hell?
My friends have absolutely roasted me.
I'm not surprised, and I'm not being funny, but you might have thought, you and a certain person might have thought it's a good idea to like put cream on one side of it, jam on the other, and think, oh well, this is practical because you bite into it and you get a bit of both. No, no. That's the most ridiculous thing I've ever heard. And it didn't work, practically, as we saw.
Made a mess.
Made more than a mess. Gave us an opportunity to swear, though, which is good.
Yeah, it did. Right. New Year's resolutions. Now, well, we've written about New Year. It's the New Year's resolutions and life update. It's more of a life update because I think both of us concede that New Year's resolutions are not one for us. But I've got a bit of a quiz for you.
Okay.
That you're probably unexpected.
I host quizzes, Dom. I don't do quizzes.
I know.
Okay.
Well, not anymore. We'll get on to that later. What are the top five New Year's resolutions?
Lose weight. It's got to be number one.
No, number four.
What?
Losing weight is number four.
Oh, wow. Okay. Be happy.
Not strictly, but I'll give you that. Number three, improving mental wellness. Okay.
That's number three? What?
Yeah, so you've got three and four, so you've got one, two, and five to get.
Okay, get fitter / healthier.
Number one,
okay.
Yeah.
Drink less. / eat better.
Improving diet is number five, so you've got number two to get.
God, that's number five.
Yeah.
If this was, what was that quiz? Where they said, oh, you said this, but our panel said, and it goes,
I've
done all right.
Yeah,
I've got four out of five. Number two. Crap, I don't know.
I'll give you a clue. It's not to do with yourself specifically, but it's to do with something that you can either gain or lose.
Money.
Yes, improving finances.
Improve finances. Okay.
Yeah. Number one, improving fitness. Number two, improving finances. Number three, improving mental well-being. Number four, losing weight. Number five, improving diet. Well done.
Thank you very much.
Hashtag nailed it.
Maybe this is all those years of hosting quizzes put me in good stead.
I'd like to point out I've got about 30 ideas for top fives. So, But that means that we can then go on to like a little bit of our New Year's resolution and life updates. I don't know how detailed we want to go into this because we're an hour into this podcast, but the first 15 minutes we're going to have to cut out, aren't we?
Yeah.
Little 10 minutes.
Yeah.
So we're 50 minutes in. And I think...
I can't go into a lot of detail anyway, Dom.
No.
Right?
And I...
So...
I can and I can't, I suppose, is a term, which sounds a bit like weird to be sort of saying, on the podcast, we're going to talk about this year.
But we're not.
Like, there's not much, we're not. It's like, surprise!
We've got a surprise segment. We're going to be talking about ourselves and our lives and the surprises, but we're not.
We're not going to go into details. I mean, I could go into a little bit more details than yourself, but I think yours is quite philosophical. Yeah. And mine is like, I'm doing this and I'm doing this and I'm doing that.
Well, yes. Yes, in terms of what we're going to reveal.
Yes.
I'll explain more when I get to my bit, but yeah.
Do you want me to go first?
Yeah, you go first.
Yeah, I mean, like, very simply, I'm about to go to hospital this afternoon after this. I'd like to point out it's quarter past 11, and I'm about to have a pre-assessment for hip surgery. Woohoo!
As you do on a Sunday. That's a really traditional Sunday thing to do.
I know, and my surgery is currently booked for the 18th of February, which is a Sunday as well.
Lovely. So you have a roast, have an op.
Well,
traditional
no,
Sunday thing instead of going for a walk.
Because the the op
can't.
Is booked for 7 a.m. So I've got to be at the hospital for 7 a.m.
And you can't eat.
Of which I live half an
hour. You can't eat 12 hours before. Well, or 24 hours.
Well, that's a good thing, I suppose, because I'm going to be asleep.
Yeah, true.
Yeah, I don't have to eat for 12 hours. Yeah, so I can't eat after 7 p.m. the night before, I think. That's what they've said. And I can't drink anything but water as well. And water has to be stopped at like 5 a.m. So basically, I'm going to stop drinking and when I wake up, not drink anything.
This will make you laugh. Got a quick story, by the way. Oh, sorry. No, go on. I interrupted you.
Go.
No, so... Years and years ago. Well, actually, it wasn't that long ago. I basically tore the lining of my stomach near where the belly button is because I was jumping with my daughter on the trampoline, holding her, and that was So I got a hernia, and I was in absolute agony. It just got worse and worse, and I was in so much pain that night I didn't really eat much. I had an early dinner. I said, I'm just going to have something light. And, you know, I'm not feeling 100%. I need to go and lie down. Anyway, woke up the next morning and I'd only had a cup of tea and the pain was unbearable. So I phoned the doctor and said, look, I've got to come and see you. And I went to the doctor and they said, yeah, we've referred you.
Back when going to see the doctor was actually achievable for mere mortals.
Well, exactly. But even then I had to really push it because I was like, look, I really do need to see somebody quite urgently. So fair play to them. And I went in the morning, so I'd had a cup of tea, and I said to my boss at the time, I've got to go in, I'm not feeling good. And anyway, they did a few tests and things, and basically I was in absolute agony. I said, you need to step out, and then I'll call you back in a minute. They called me back in, and then they said, right, I've phoned Stoke Mandeville Hospital, they're expecting you in A&E, you need to go home, pack a bag, don't eat anything, you need to make your way there. Now, I think you need to have surgery. So I was like, what? So anyway, did that, packed the bag, said to work, sorry, you're going to have to like look after everything yourselves. I've got to go to the hospital. So I went to the hospital. And do you know what? I was in hospital for that whole day. They didn't operate on me. They operated on me the following day. And they kept saying to me, no, you can't eat, you can't eat. So I didn't eat for 2.5 days. I was like, what the fringe? Lying on this hospital bed, waiting to be seen. Oh, it was awful. Anyway,
yeah. I mean, I'm hoping mine won't be as bad because I have to admit I've had to go private for this one. And
no, yours will be fine. Just eat. Just make sure you up to the point where you're allowed to just eat, like feast, like it was no tomorrow, like a Roman feast, like a Roman.
Well, it's a Sunday, so it'll be a Saturday, so I've got plenty of time. I'm not doing anything exactly before, because I don't think I am.
I don't know. I haven't got access to your calendar.
I do. You'd hope I'd have access to my calendar. No, I've got nothing before.
Okay.
That's good.
Feast, young man, feast.
So yeah, okay. I'm having a hip arthroscopy because I have torn all the cartilage in my hip.
If you're going to do it properly.
Oh, you've done that properly.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Poor Leroy. Loads of cool stuff about it. Like the doctor that I was to see was really in depth. Just some really interesting facts. But I just need to clear out all the gunk from my hip. Apparently the way that they do it is they have to dislocate your hip as well, and then he's going to get some sandpaper and go on either side, make it nice and smooth, and then clonk it back in.
Nice. Oh, that's horrible.
Hashtag tasty.
Oh, that's horrible.
What's interesting about it is the people that I've seen to kind of have a look at it, they're all like, oh, you've done this properly. Well, this is what we're going to do. And then if you read my letter, which I gave to my chiropractor yesterday, and she translated it for me, there's a section that I was like, I don't really know what that means, because it's like intravenous, da 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 da. And she went, oh, basically, they're going to open you up and then they're going to figure out what they're going to do. And I was like, surely they know. And she's like, no, that's not how it works. They can make all the guests, they can make very educated guests oh, wow. with your MRI and X-ray. But sometimes they open up and go, oh, that's new. So I was like, okay, that's great.
Oh my God. So it's like improv.
Yeah, it's complete, like, it's complete improv. I mean, actually, how in depth of these stories can I go? So when I was getting the second MRI, I think you might have heard this. Obviously, I'm lying on the table and they're taking an X-ray trying to inject the dye into my leg. So I'm lying there and he puts some local anaesthetic in and then he gets the dye needle, puts it in, squeezes it, takes the X-ray photo. And then he goes, interesting. And I'm lying there going, what's interesting? Like, I've got nothing on my lower half and you're injecting me with a needle. Anyway, so he takes that out, comes back, sticks another one in, squeezes it, takes another X-ray and he goes, okay. Takes that one out, comes back with another needle, sticks that in, squeezes it. He goes, And I'm like, am I doing something wrong? And he goes, no, it's all fine. Comes back with the fourth one, jabs that in, squeeze it, and I can feel that one. I can feel my hip joint expanding on that one when he's injected it. And he takes the photo and goes, aha, I got it. And I went, what do you mean? He went, you had too much muscle around your hip. I couldn't get the needle. I had to get the biggest needle to get the dye into your hip. And I was like, is that a good thing? And he went, oh, it means you're very strong. And I went, the joys of Taekwondo. That's what they do.
Well, with the amount of kicking the as other well, interest- as a martial art, for those who don't know, it's... What percentage of kicks versus punches actually? There's more kicks than punches, is that right?
I mean, if you look at the if you look at the WT, so the Olympic Taekwondo, they can't score with punches. Now I don't do that, I do traditional, which is a bit more kickboxing. Right. But your legs are longer than your arms. So we use our legs like our jab.
Yeah. Right.
So that leg will come out as a side, bang, bang, bang. Like that's generally how it is. In terms of like patterns, I think Swanee's actually head of our technical committee, and he would know this. But it's something like 20% of the pattern movements of kicks, and that increases as you get higher. I've got kicks that are like head height and things like that. So it's not. You do a lot of kicks, and actually, our line work quite often is just pure kicks. So, yeah, your hip flexors, your glutes, your quads, your abductors. And adductors are usually very, very strong. So I've got very strong muscles around there because I've just used, you drill and you drill and you drill. And particularly on my right-hand side, I've torn my abductor, which is the one on the inside of your leg. And I've torn my right glute as well. So I've had a lot of rehab to kind of fix them back in. So they are particularly strong. And I'm right-legged, so that's the one I use most. But the other interesting bit about my hips, so for those that don't know, and I'm showing my hand, obviously your hip is a ball and socket joint, so your hip sort of sits like that. The amount of cartilage you have is very small, which is why they're not repairing it, they're removing it. They're going to get a big piece of sandpaper and just go, just get rid of it. Because if the stitching is bigger than the cartilage, so if you stitched it back together, yeah, that fine. If it was your shoulder, it's different because there's a lot more, which is why you've got a lot more movement in your shoulder than you do in your hip.
Okay.
Testing your shoulder, like your hip, your hip probably stops at about 90 degrees. Depends on your muscle flexibility.
Yeah.
Whereas your shoulder can just come straight, can come, in my particular case, and come up to about 75 degrees. Things like that. And then you end up with two types of hip joints. So you've got a contour where the hip socket and the ball kind of sit nicely. And I think it's a vice, I think is the way that he called it, where it's a little bit more impinged, but actually you end up with more flexibility because the hips normally adjust for that. Okay. And it's more common in females because their hips have adapted to evolution for childbirth. So my left hip, because when you take an MRI, you do all of it. My left hip, and I quote, and my mother, this is the bit that is perfect on me. My left hip is the most perfect contour that he's ever seen. And he's like, you should have no problems with that. And I'm like, I don't. It's great. It's wonderful. My right hip, and he said, I've never seen this before. Your right hip's a vice hip. I've never seen someone with two different hips. Normally hips are, you know, semi-symmetrical.
No way.
So yeah, so that's one of the reasons why I have trouble with my right, more like to have trouble with my right hip. So there's also going to be an element of there's also going to be an element of shaving down the hip socket joint, because I've got a notch, and to try and make it more contour like, so to hopefully prevent the impingement going forward.
Flipping egg. Okay.
So yay, surgery.
Good luck with that.
Yeah. And then the other two bit, the other three bits, I think I could, are a little bit quicker. Oh, I'm also going for a root canal on Wednesday as well. On a Tuesday.
Sorry, it came across as really facetious. In all seriousness, I hope everything goes well with that. No,
yeah. Yeah, I do as well. It'd be nice to not be in pain for the first time.
It would be good. That would be good.
So yeah, by the end of March, I will have had a root canal and major hip surgery.
Wow. Nice.
Double sarcastic thumbs up. Yay.
I'm just shaking my head. That's brutal.
Yeah. Hashtag brutality.
Right, no, that is brutal.
Yeah. My dad's at least been kind enough. He's going to drive me to the root canal on Tuesday. Jeez. We got to drive.
How many operations have you had, Dom, in your life?
In total? Yeah. I've only had one other operation in under general.
Oh, okay.
And I was like, I think I was about, was it pre-sister or post-sister? I don't know. It's my earliest memory. And the reason being is because the general anaesthetic is stuck in as a needle into your hand. Hmm. And I was very young. I can't have been more than between 2 and 4. So if it's, I was 2 if it's pre-sister and 4 if it was post-sister. And all I remember it because there were 7 of them trying to pin me down and I was winning.
Get
this needle in my hand. I was not having it. I was not in a happy state. So yes, and that was for grommets for me.
Oh, you had grommets as well.
But other than that, I've not had any major surgery. I've had a root canal before, but nothing major. Right. Major. And teeth removed and things like that. But,
oh my god, yeah. You don't come across many people that have had grommets. Wow, nope. Both had grommets.
Yeah. Is that what makes us like connected?
Yeah, maybe. I mean, I've had 10 operations in total under general.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. But I started very young, same as you. I think I was around 3.
Anymore, Jerry.
Hmm?
I'm not young anymore.
Well.
Oh, I see what you mean.
No. I was 3, I think, when I had mine. First one. I ended up having, I think it was 2 or 3 grommet operations. 3, okay. I think, in total.
Oh, no, I think I had one. Okay. In fact, I can even remember what I had for breakfast, for what I had for food right after.
Really? Wow.
Yeah, Frosties.
Oh, my God. You've got a good memory.
It's my earliest memory. Hell. It's the only, like, it's when I talk about my poor long-term memory, I just have specific scenarios.
That have stuck with you. Yeah.
I don't, but if somebody said, what happened on the 27th of January 2005, I probably don't know.
Oh, I remember that day. I had a curry. Actually, what day was it? If it was a Friday, I had a curry.
let's have a look. What did I say? January the 27th.
Yeah. 2005.
What happened?
It'd be so funny if that's a Friday.
It's a Thursday.
Oh, okay. I was looking at the menu, preparing for what curry I was going to have on the Friday.
What happened? Conflict in Iraq. National railway strike.
That's almost a daily occurrence. So, I don't even know why they bothered making a note of that.
If I go to look, what happened? Day of the week, Thursday. How long ago? 19 years and one day. Leap year, no. Generation Z, if you're born. It was the Chinese zodiac of the monkey, and the star sign was Aquarius. And the number one song was Let Me Love You by Mario.
Oh my God, I remember that. Okay.
So the other bits, I suppose, that's just happening, I suppose, to talk about. I'm going to use air quotes, a promotion at work this month. So I think the best way to just skim over this quickly is a lot more responsibility and fun times.
We've already talked about this, Dom, so I'm just going to go
zip,
zip, zip, zip. I'm saying nothing.
That just reminds me of Zebedee. Wasn't that the thing with the spring from the Magic
Zebedee,
Roundabout?
Yeah, the Magic Roundabout, Zebedee. Yeah, but you had Zippy as well from... You had Zippy,
from
George
Rainbow.
And Bungle, didn't you? Rainbow. So I'm Zippy.
And George.
I'm not even going to try George and do the... I can't do the impressions, yeah.
I can't remember that one. So that's going to be fun. Got that to get used to. The other bit is I'm creating content outside of the podcast.
Woo.
So I'm re-uploading to my gaming channel. Nothing's going to come out until July because I'm not sure I've got the cycle correctly, because I'm currently trying to do 3 videos a week, and that's going to probably prove quite difficult to sustain, I think. But maybe not. Never know. Along with everything else in life. But it means I've got plenty of time to update. And it's quite nice. I can talk about things and be like, in 6 months, you're going to hear about 6 months ago. So,
but it's exciting, though. That's really exciting. Yeah. I mean, I know you and I have talked about this, and I'm really pleased that you're doing it, Dom.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
And
yeah.
Even if nobody watches it, it's just nice to just kind of get, just to create something else. But also...
It's creative, yeah.
Yeah, it convinces... Well, it's not even that creative. It just gets me to finish video games, which I don't do, and... But I'm just recording because I'm forced to then do the video games. And I'm doing them quicker because I don't just wander around aimlessly. I'm like, I'm being recorded. I need to do stuff consistently. And there's a little bit of editing.
Yeah, there's no time for flim-flam.
Yeah, we ain't got time for flim-flam in here.
We got time for flim-flam.
The other bit around it as well, actually, is what I had the idea is I'm actually going to, at the end, because I'm doing walkthroughs, of video games, and I've chosen the world's biggest walkthrough in life, right? I've done 20 episodes over an hour and a half each. So there's 30 hours of content already, and I've done the storyline, but I haven't done like all the bits that I said I wanted to do. What I find interesting from it is I might at the end do another sort of hour and a half movie, but like condensed cutting down of important story sequences with a commentary to kind of build my editing skills up, but which could be fun. I might do that as well. And the last bit is I'm finally going to try and buy a house this year. He says,
that'd be really good, though.
Have you seen the bloody market though?
Oh. Yeah, don't even go there.
So, yes, we got that fun. But that's hopefully, if I don't achieve the house hunting this year, like the first three have started. The house hunting, I'm going to start the house hunting. If I don't achieve getting a house, that's...
There's factors outside of your control with that, right? Yeah. So, yeah.
I'm house hunting. Whether I find a house is another matter. Like, I'm taking my time. So,
and that's moving away from the goal. No, what was it that you said?
It's not goal. The goal,
Yeah,
the goal, the it's moving away from a goal-oriented thing. Find a house, because once I found a house, I'm done. It's actually more towards my thing is to work hard. One of those things I'm going to work hard at is house hunting.
Yeah,
but I've got to do all of the house hunting bits, so that's going to be like everything to do with it. So mortgage, finding one, purchasing one, doing all the surveyor stuff, and then learning DIY so I can get it more to how I want and getting people in to do how I want it. You know, getting a house to a nice state, learning to live in the new area and change, different routines and things. I'm planning to move away from where I currently live quite far. It's quite far, a couple of hours down the road. You know, there's those types of situations and scenarios which are going to change things and things like that. So it's all about learning to work hard, but I'm going to achieve something while I'm doing it.
Yeah, good. Good for you, Dom. Good for
you. Life update. New Year's resolution update.
Nice. Oh, crap. Is it my go?
It's your go.
I'm going to be doing stuff. There you go. Right. Move on to the next section. No. I can't give any details. What did I write, actually? I'm just having a look at the notes. Big life change is going to happen this year. Well, it is happening. It is happening.
It is happening.
I'm going through the painful process of that happening. Like I said, can't go into detail, but and it's definitely the toughest thing I've ever done.
Mm.
By a long shot.
By a good gym mark.
Oh yeah. It really is actually the toughest thing I've ever had to deal with. Mm. Which is a big statement to make considering the amount of
gump
deaths of close friends of mine over the years that I've had to deal with and a whole bunch of other stuff that I've had to deal with. But I would say this is definitely the one that's really, really testing me to the max. And like I say, what's the theme of the change is basically me going through the process of learning to be true to myself.
Yes.
So, and I put a link into a really interesting page that that's actually entitled 10 Signs You're Being True to Yourself. Yeah. And I don't normally like this. I don't like this whole, you know, everything that's got to be quantified, 3 steps to doing this, 7 signs that you're this, and, you know, 8 steps to, you know, it's like, bloody hell. How about one step to... yeah, it's like, how about one step to just go away? But this yeah, exactly. But this website's actually really... It's an interesting article, actually. It's a blog. It's a blog post. And it says... it says, you know you're being true to yourself if you're honest with yourself about what you think, feel, want, and need, which I've realized over the months that I haven't been.
Mm-hmm.
It says, you freely share your thoughts and feelings, which I do, and it has got me into trouble as well.
It's an interesting one, isn't it? Like, with... in everybody in the corporate world, I think, tries to be very political, and I don't think it works. Because people often get offended then when you go, I think that's really silly. I think that's a dumb idea. Right?
Well, yes.
But sometimes you need to be like that. Some people need to be told what, like the illogicalness of some things. You just think, what the possessed you to even think like that? But yes.
I tried to mute. Before coughing, I can't mute.
Oh, fine.
Oh, now it lets me mute.
I just saw the little mute button pop up, and then he went. I heard him say something, and I saw him say something. And I don't know.
I love the way it just goes. Oh, look, Jerry needs to cough. Don't mute. Don't mute. And then when I stop, it goes. Go on, mute.
I talked about this in the episode actually of the game that I was playing. This slight tangent. Good old Distinct and Jovial tangents. Here we come.
But- we love them.
I was trying to do a specific achievement on the game, which was to bring, long story short, but basically it's to bring a tamed lion to a crocodile, right? And I'd found the lion and tamed it, and now I was trying to find a crocodile. And I was in an area where there should be plenty. Was there a bloody crocodile anywhere? No, there was not. It took me a good 20 minutes to find a crocodile. And I said, My theory is that games have a conspiracy that they are coded that they know you're going for a specific achievement to deliberately make it harder just to wind you up.
I've always wondered that.
I reckon they do.
Yeah.
And it isn't. It's entirely RNG.
Okay.
Random number generator RNG. But it isn't. Like, because it's also how you then perceive it. So, yes.
Interesting.
Make things harder for yourself.
Well, by the way, I wear my heart on my sleeve work-wise anyway, but I tend to do that anyway.
Yes.
That's me. I'm really rubbish at hiding feelings, and I am very open. Interestingly enough, I was having a conversation with somebody the other day, literally just the other day. I always perceive myself as being somebody that doesn't trust people by default, and you know, I'm always very cautious and I'm not very open until I start to get to know somebody. But then I realized in the course of that conversation, I realized actually, no, I'm the complete opposite.
Yeah,
I am actually the complete opposite, which is a bit crazy. It's almost like I've been fighting that, but almost because I suppose so few people are like that I've almost perceived it as a sign of weakness. That's just all in my head, by the way. I'm not saying that anyone's ever said that to me. But I think saying how you feel and sharing your thoughts and feelings is, it puts you in such a vulnerable position. And I've had that abused both inside of work and outside of work as well.
I know what you mean.
Which is interesting.
No, I know what you mean. Because I'm a heart and my sleeve person. Everybody knows how I feel. I'm very, like my two values are openness and honesty. So I quite often am like, yeah. Do you know what? Honestly, there are times where like, this is how I feel. And the one that kills me is thinking somebody's eventually going to go, oh, Dom's talking about how shit his life is again. Right. And do you know what I mean? Like people will eventually get fed up of what I said. And I've said this to people, you know, KP and the Sunshine band specifically, right. I've said, I don't want to keep talking about the same thing I'm struggling with. And she's like, why? And I said, because you're going to get fed up. She goes, no. Are you an idiot? Well, yes, but...
Well, like, you know. Yeah, if you feel the need... And that's the whole point, isn't it? If you feel the need to talk about it, then that's clearly the right thing to do.
But also you need
to beat yourself up about it.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, well, that's what I mean. And that's, you need to... Yeah.
And that's what I think people, vulnerable people then struggle with, is that you then talk about your stuff and then you feel guilty for talking about your stuff. So you feel guilty and then you feel guilty for feeling guilty. And then you you might as well just yeet yourself down the snowball hill.
You might as well. I mean, anytime you should feel guilty. Well, yeah, but the only time you should feel guilty is if somebody gets on the call with you and says, by the way, Dom, if you're going to talk about X, Y, and Z, I don't want to hear it. And then you start talking about X, Y, and Z. Yeah. And then fine, feel guilty. But that's not the case, obviously, with KP and the Sunshine Band. So it's not actually that easy to say, is it, KP and the Sunshine Band?
That's only because I call it KP.
Exactly.
You came up with that. It's you with your nicknames.
But it's easier to say KC and the Sunshine Band, because that's sort of what I've grown up with over the years. But KP and the Sunshine Band doesn't roll off the tongue as easily. I don't know why. But these are the two kickers, and then we'll move on. Yeah. So points number 7 and 8 in this article.
Oh, I haven't got that far.
Point number 7. Was you listen to your intuition and trust that you know what's best for yourself.
Okay.
So that is what I've been doing. And also, you do what feels right for you, even if that means risking disapproval from the people around you. That's also an interesting one.
That is very interesting. Because basically, number 8 is removing the people-pleasing aspect of your life, which I still haven't got rid of. And number 7,
which has ruled me, Dom. I've realized just how much it has ruled me.
Yeah, number 7 is an interesting one. And I don't want to take away from you. I don't do that. I think the person I trust the least is me, 100%, easily. So got some stuff to work on. just hashtag just saying.
Yeah, well I think that's... So,
I don't think it's a bad thing, by the way, actually, at the moment.
No, I don't think... this isn't good or bad. It is... You can only judge it in the context of the impact that it has on you. So I question everything. Yeah. I overthink everything.
Yeah.
Because that's what I've always done. And then, even when I make a decision on something, I still question it the whole time. I don't, that's not true, but I have moments, even if it's something I'm absolutely sure about. I do still always have moments where I think, oh my God, you know, should I be doing this? Shouldn't I be doing this? Is this right? This is not. Sometimes the urge to just move forward and move in a direction can overtake that urge to overthink something that can paralyze you.
Yeah, absolutely.
So,
agree with that.
You don't want to get to that thinking paralysis or fear paralysis kind of thing. It's a worse position. Analysis paralysis, exactly that.
Yeah, it's a very common trait amongst people that care, I think.
Yeah, 100%.
That's not saying other people don't care that don't have this, but that there's a balance between caring too much and caring too little, isn't there? And you're always walking that line.
Well, again, what's caring too much?
Caring too much that you don't do anything.
Yeah. So that's what I mean about there's no right and wrong in this. It's just what impact does that then have on you? And actually even for some people, caring too much to the point where they don't do anything might be right for them.
Yeah,
but it might not
I
be right for you or me.
We discussed this like four kind of like pillar or whatever you want to call it, where you've got, you know, you've got something in the middle, but then on the right you've got selflessness, so you know, being, you know, caring, but then you've got people pleasing. So you can go be too selfless that you just people please. And then you've got self-care, selfishness. And they're all on the same spectrum. It's just how far to the left and the right that you go. And if you swing between the middle two ones, then great, right? You've got to have some self-care. You've got to have some selflessness. But if you go into people-pleasing or selfishness, then yes, you're at a kind of a bit of a disadvantage there. And I think one of the things I think I've learned is that there is too much, you can have too much of a good thing. Like I can be too selfless. I can do too much self-care that it becomes the extreme. It's the same way you can have too many vegetables because you know, et cetera, et cetera. There is a possibility to poison yourself by eating too many bananas or whatever it is. Although I think that's a myth. I think you have to eat something stupid like 47 bananas. And I'm like,
yeah, you'd never be able to eat all of that. Yeah, you wouldn't be able to.
Along the fact that that is about, it's about 200 calories per banana. So 47 bananas in a day is about 8,000 calories. Well, 40 bananas would be probably 8,000 calories. Yeah. So it's probably nearer 10,000 calories. That's a lot of calories.
It's a lot of calories. You know, it's something interesting on what you just said there as well with regards to how far that pendulum swings one way or the other. I remember a few years ago, I did the Myers-Briggs. Well, it was, everything's Myers-Briggs based, isn't it? It wasn't exactly Myers-Briggs, but it's Myers-Briggs based personality type profile. And I just remember the person who was facilitating this course. She pulled me to one side and she said, "Do you know, in all the years I've been doing this, I don't think I've ever seen a profile quite as severe as this." And I said, "What?" She said, "You tend to fall into apart from introvert, extrovert, but even that, in some circumstances, you're kind of in the middle." But she said, on so many different aspects of this profile, you're in the middle with regards to...
Nobody puts Jerry in the corner.
Yeah, no one puts... Yeah, so Jerry always stays in the middle. She said, "You must be exhausted." She said, "You must be absolutely
exhausted."
That's
a nice thing for somebody to say, isn't it?
I know. But the funny thing was, she was right. Because it just took me back. And I said, "Well, why do you think that is?" And she said, "Basically, because you consider everything before you do it and consider the consequences of everything before you do it and keep going through that process as you're doing it." Mm. And I said, "Yeah." She said, "Do you sleep well at night?" So I bet you don't. I said, "No, I don't." At all.
Like, I don't know whether I feel flawed now because I sleep fine. I'm like, oh, I bet.
Oh, really? Yeah, I don't sleep well at all. So
interesting.
It's funny what she picked up on.
The person that we mentioned before the podcast, who is wise beyond her years, absolutely, one of the wisest people, and asks the most... just the questions, and you think, that's such a good question, but I don't have to answer. But I reckon she probably suffers similar with this. 100%.
Yeah.
Not calling her out too much. I haven't mentioned her name, so it's okay. But she'll know who she is. Either that, or it's the ghosts that are inheriting her house, which is a whole different discussion. Which I want to get on the podcast and discuss that, because that would be brilliant. Because we love a good conspiracy theory on here.
We do. We do. And I do believe in ghosts, by the way. Well, yes. Yeah, I do. Anyway.
Yeah. It's all good. Should we move on to some poignant questions? Sorry, pick
this. Let's do it.
Poignant question number one. Was maths discovered or invented?
It was invented.
I thought you said to me the other day it was discovered.
No. I said invented.
Invented.
Because the discovery is a bit, because maths is a systematic, I don't know, for want of a better word, framework of framework. I don't know. I don't know how you describe it, but it's somebody had to basically put everything into a system, didn't they? Which is, that system is maths. So maths was invented.
Yeah.
Sorry. Yeah, it was. It was invented, not discovered. Yeah.
Yeah, it was. It's interesting. I'd like to put that as maths. It's got an S on the end. It's a plural.
Okay.
Stupid. No, it's mathematics, not mathematic. American. It's interesting. The fact that 1 plus 1 equals 2, or that there's an infinite number of primes, are truths about reality that are held before mathematicians knew about them. So they're discoveries. Would you agree? Or have I lost you again on the internet? No, you're there. I've seen you blink.
I'm thinking. What? Are you saying that before maths was invented, that people knew about that?
If I've got an apple and another apple, so that's two things, that will always equal... So therefore I've got two things. One and one will always equal two. Regardless, before we knew it. So it was that was discovered.
Yeah, but one... But that's our... That's what we've constructed. So we've created the words one and the concept of one.
As such, they're discoveries, but they were made using techniques invented by mathematicians. For example, according to Pythagoras' theorem, the square of the hypotenuse of a right-angled triangle is equal to the sum of the squares of the other two sides. A squared plus B squared equals C squared. This is true for all right-angled triangles on a level surface, so it's a discovery using invented techniques. Showing it is true, however, requires the invention of a proof. And over the centuries, mathematicians have devised hundreds of different techniques capable of proving the theorem. In short, maths is both invented and discovered.
And discovered. Oh.
So the core principles of the universe are discovered using techniques that are invented to make those discoveries.
Got it. Oh, okay. Yeah. That actually wraps that up nicely.
Let's burrito this.
Can't argue with that. Let's burrito that one. God, that's interesting. Okay.
If trees could talk, would you trust them?
Yes, I would.
Interesting. You're straight in there.
I'll tell you why. Because I watched a documentary on trees and just how amazing they are.
Mm.
So, and I can't remember how they do this, but basically when there's a forest fire, there's a whole root system in a forest where trees communicate with one another.
Right.
So trees that are on the receiving end of that fire will communicate to other trees that are on the receiving end of that fire, and it can make some of the trees actually shed some of the seeds or whatever, that the trees basically react and prepare themselves.
Mm-hmm.
And trees, so a forest is an actual living organism.
Yeah.
It's not just a randomly plotted series of trees, but trees do look out for one another. So yeah, I would trust a tree.
Do you reckon they'd be
such
as wise?
A random question.
No, but do you reckon they'd be as wise as they would be in most books? Because like, in books, most trees are depicted as wise.
I think they would be, but I think they're depicted like that because trees can live for so long.
Mm.
So a tree can be around for hundreds and hundreds of years, and so, I mean, there was a tree. Well, I say hundreds, thousands. So when I went to Madeira, there was an olive tree in the gardens there that had been planted by the Romans in 300 BC.
So my argument on this one, how to phrase this? A tree doesn't move. And does age necessarily denote wisdom? Because I've met some really stupid old people. And experience in life, so for example, right, like somebody that's traveled the world and could be in their 40s, which I would say is probably wiser and has more experience than somebody that is how to phrase it, like who's not done that, like who's just sat in like their Terence house in Swindon and like never experienced anything outside of their four walls, could be older but have way less wisdom and experience.
Yeah, true. I think if you're thinking about it in general, I think that's why trees are portrayed that way, because of the fact that they can grow to be so old. So trees do tend to, so long as nothing happens to them, will outlive us.
Yes.
If all the conditions are right, right? So old, people always say, oh yeah, old and wise. They always put the two together, but actually old doesn't always mean wise, because you're right. if you have somebody that's, well, take somebody that's had experiences even in the first 10 or 20 years of their life.
Mm-hmm.
And they could have, you know, there are people that are in conflict zones and war zones, or have been, you know, God forbid, they've been abused, or you know, or even they've had a really cushy life, but because of their parents, they've ended up traveling the world and
experienced different cultures
and things. So as you say, as opposed to somebody that's like 80 years old sitting in their terraced house, it's like, I've never left, I don't know, whatever town. In all the years Swindon, I've been here, yeah, there you go. I've never left Swindon. I've spent all my whole life in this house, and
yeah, it's just interesting. I brought it up because obviously trees don't move, but your point is interesting, where they can communicate with other trees, and it's like, what have they overheard from other people that have brought news to them? So
yeah, they prepare themselves. Something worth googling, because it is fascinating how trees, they do communicate and do. If there is a forest fire or something, yeah, or trees get diseased. They communicate to other trees to say, I'm not well. And yeah, it's incredible. So forests are actual living organisms, like one organism, basically.
Interesting.
Hmm.
So my final poignant question from myself, because the rest are yours. Do you ever wear a jumper or hoodie without a t-shirt underneath?
No.
Absolute heathens, people that do that. I can't. Layers are the best thing ever.
Why would you do that? Layers, yeah, layer it. Even if it's really hot, it doesn't feel right to wear a hoodie without a t-shirt underneath. I don't know why, because it's almost like wearing a jacket without anything underneath.
Yeah. I wouldn't wear a leather jacket without a t-shirt on underneath, right? Or something like that. Or exactly. A blazer without anything on underneath.
Or a blazer. Exactly. So why would you wear a hoodie without a t-shirt underneath?
Good. I'm glad that we agree on that one. And I'm glad that's now out there. Right, your poignant questions, go.
It's one of the thousands of things that we agree on.
Yes.
How much deeper would oceans be if sponges didn't live there? We'd never be able to quantify that.
Do sea sponges actually absorb water?
Probably not. I don't think they're sponges in the traditional sense.
No, I mean, like, I want to generally work with this a little bit. So, like, a sponge can hold so much water.
Yeah.
Right? But to take water away, the sponge needs to be removed from the water. Whereas if the sponge is still in the water, that water is still in the ocean. But actually, all you're doing is you're then invoking Archimedes' principle, which is where you're adding...
Displacement.
Displacement.
Yeah.
So, arguably, if you removed all the sponges... Actually, the water levels would shrink.
Possibly.
And I did that with mathematics that was invented and discovered.
There you go. Don't know in that principle which happened first, but as you know, it was discovered through an invention.
Exactly.
Actually, that's no chicken and egg. That's an infinite loop. There's no start or end point on that.
No. Full circle.
Yeah, or it could be like ice cubes, and you put ice cubes in, but the water level doesn't increase or decrease as it melts.
Yeah, because because it's an equal thing.
Because I don't know.
But that's for any like people that then say that global warming is not a thing, I'd like to point out that that only happens because the water density is exactly the same in the ice cube as it is in the water, because you use the same water that you've probably filled your glass up. The reason why the water levels will rise with icebergs is because icebergs are made from fresh water and the sea is salt water, and so there is a density differential.
Exactly.
So not only do you get the water levels rising, you are also then desaltifying the sea, which is very important for it to be full of salt, because that's all the fish, you know, require it. Well, all the sea creatures require it to be like that to survive. That's why you get saltwater crocodiles and non-saltwater crocodiles.
Exactly.
So don't come.
And then when you pluck those fish out of the sea, all you have to worry about is vinegar and chips.
And I don't mind. I'm not a fan of vinegar.
I love vinegar.
But chips, fish and chips from a beach, independent fish and chip shop. Best things ever.
Yeah, great. You just have to avoid the sand. Okay. I think we might have talked about this before, but I can't remember what the conclusion was. Do you technically eat soup or drink it?
It depends on the soup, surely.
Oh, if it's a smooth soup.
Yeah.
Like a blended soup. Are you drinking that or eating
it? Like cream of chicken is probably more yeah. a drink, unless you're dipping bread into it. Whereas like a chunky vegetable soup is probably more of an eat.
Yeah, you're eating it. Yeah, chunky vegetables or chunky any chunky soup.
Yeah.
That's easy. But if it's something like a cream of tomato, are you drinking that or eating it?
Mm. I would say I'm eating soup. I wouldn't say I'm drinking soup. Because that sounds like a heathen.
But even though you could drink it from a mug.
I will do.
Couldn't you?
You will do. Because you'll eat, or you'll dip your bread into it until you get to a certain point, and then you might have a dreg at the bottom, which you probably tip the bowl up and drink it.
Okay. So we're both agreed. So we both agree that you default to eating soup, you don't drink it.
Yeah. I would say I'm eating soup, but you would drink it. I would say I'm eating. But you could drink it.
Okay. Okay.
Question on that.
Okay.
Cereal. Bowl of cereal with milk. Is that a soup?
No.
Why?
No. Why? Because it's just a lot of liquid on what is essentially solid. The key thing that you're eating is a cereal.
Okay. That's a fair argument. That's the best argument I've heard. Right? Nobody on the internet has managed to beat that argument.
There you go. You start with a cereal. Don't you? You just go, oh, I fancy some cereal. What you don't do is go, do you know what? I really fancy some milk, but what would go well with
add,
milk?
I'm going to add cereal
add some
to my
corn
milk.
Flakes.
Yeah, yeah. That's a good point.
Right? So, no, you're eating cereal.
Apparently.
It's not a, it's not a soup. It's not a soup. Doesn't matter how much milk you put in there. It's not a soup.
Well, you should never
by
have
the way,
too much milk.
Everybody. Yeah, exactly. Because if you have too much milk, that's fine. That's easy to deal with. If you don't have enough milk, it actually causes big problems.
And
the whole cereal eating.
Soggy
experience.
Cereal is the worst thing in the world.
Oh, it is. You've got literally a 2 minute window to eat.
And yet, if you then leave out, like if you've got like the dregs and there's some like shreddies in there or Weetabix or whatever your choice is, that becomes harder than concrete.
Yep. Yep. And you could build the next great wall using that material.
It was.
Yeah. Well, it was. Rice. Mm-hmm.
It was rice, though, but not cereal. But similar things. Look at that.
Well, it could be unless it's Rice Krispies.
Yeah, that's true. That's very true.
Right?
Snap, crackle, and pop in the Great Wall of China.
In the Great Wall of China, which is so magnificent, you can see it from anywhere in the world.
What? Yeah, if I go and Google.
That's a joke. That was a joke from one of the Father Ted episodes, which made me laugh. Yeah, it's so big, you can see it from anywhere in the world. You can see everyone in the audience going, what are you talking about?
What the fringe?
And then this one, which actually doesn't even warrant any kind of a discussion because it has to fall into the category of one of the most ridiculous questions ever. Should I tell my parents that I'm adopted?
Well, surely they know.
That's the whole point. So, yeah, there you go. We move on.
Right, okay. So, another new section. So I've got two new sections. One was the top five, and this one is to rate this. But you have to rate this hidden. So you don't know what the next thing is. So you've got to do that. So, for example, if I did, let's go cereals, right? So I might get like Shreddies first. I'll be like, oh, Shreddies is a banger, right? But put that at number two. Then I might get like Weetabix, that's rubbish, put it at five. Then I might get like Cheerios, but that's a banger, put it on number one. And then I might get like chocolate shreddies, but chocolate shreddies is both of those, but I can't put it at number one because I've already filled it.
Okay.
So this is a challenge for you. So you've got to rate these items as blind. You've got to put them one to five, but you don't know what's coming next. So you've got to try and get your list to be as accurate.
Oh my
God! Yeah.
So I can't change them, basically.
Can't change.
Once I've positioned them, in that ranking, that's it.
That's it.
Oh Jesus!
So I'm going with chocolate snacks.
Okay.
Because I was inspired by something. So your first one, Snickers.
Five.
Oh, do you not a Snickers fan? At all.
So again, I've had this this is really weird. Had this conversation the other day. So I love peanuts and I love Mars bars, and then Snickers are kind of like a mishmash of the two. But somehow they've managed to take two really good things, mash them together, And for me, it just doesn't work. And I think it's because the peanuts are kind of bitter.
Interesting.
Then, yeah.
I mean, this would be 5 for me as well. Looking at the other bits that are coming up, it would still be 5 because I can see the all 5 things, but you might be regretting your choice later on.
Okay. Oh, crap. Okay.
Number 2, it's the second one. So you've got 1 to 4 that you can place this. A mint aero bar.
4.
Okay. Mini eggs.
2.
Okay. Bounty. You've got 1 and 3 left. Do you see what I mean? You might be regretting.
I knew you were going to do this. I should have. Why didn't I think of that? Damn! I knew you were going to do this. Oh, well, I have to go 3. It's the only slot left.
Where would it go if it wasn't 3? If you could have free reign, is it better than? Was it better than
5?
It's below Mint Aero and Snickers.
Yes.
And would you have the Snickers and the Mint Aero that way round?
Yeah. So you'd have. So 5 would be Bounty. 4 would be Snickers, 3 would be Mint Aero in that case, yeah. And but I've got to slot it.
So you're number 1. Known. You're number should've 1. Known. Yeah. I don't know if this is going to work, but your number 1 is Mars Bar. Is that better than mini eggs?
So you've got no, Mars, but fine.
Mars Bar, mini eggs.
Bounty, I do like Mars Bars, though. I do like
Mint
Mars Bars.
Aero, Snickers.
Yes, I'm putting in. So Mars Bar would go in number 1. That's the only slot left. But I wouldn't put that in begrudgingly. It's actually a strong Mars Bar.
It's a strong Mars Bar.
It's a strong, yeah. The reason why I kept number 1 slot free was I thought you were going to say 12.
No, I was quite cruel on these.
That is that Bounty. How dare you?
This is good. That was good. That was a good little segment there.
Yeah, nice. Yeah. I like that.
I really like that. I've got about 20 ideas for those, so I'm just going to stick them in. And they'll work really nicely as a short for us to just put those in because I can actually edit them a little bit more and be like,
excellent. I love that. I absolutely love that, Dom. That's genius. Thank you.
Right. And our next quick section, I don't know if you've had a thought about this. So I don't know if you've checked our next podcast notes, but I'm thinking of doing a movie review one because we've missed a few movies. We've got the 2 of Sam Houses to do.
We have.
What other things have we got to do? I should have had this open. Here is where I didn't blue Peter it.
Well, there was a whole load of baking we were supposed to do. There was all sorts of stuff we were supposed to do.
So we're gonna do like a catch up. I think a catch up episode and stuff. So we've got some baking, we've got some cooking to do. So we're gonna have a catch up episode next, is what I've currently done. So we've got the 2 of Samwise's choice. We could watch the Boondock Saints as well to see what we thought of that comment choice that somebody put in. Okay. And then I thought, well, we're going to need a few more movies than that so we're going to choose a classic for each of us that the other person has to watch, that needs to watch this, or should have watched by now. Well,
but one that they haven't seen before?
One that we think that they haven't seen before.
They think they haven't seen before. Okay.
So I've got mine. I don't know if you've got a movie for me.
Where do I start with that? So many good films. So many good films. I honestly don't know where to start. I could choose from one of 10 films straight off the bat. Mm. So it's not going to be a problem choosing a film if I just choose one of them.
Which one do you think?
So what, you want me to go first?
Yeah. Pick one. Pick the one that you want.
So to be clear, I'm naming a film that basically I want you to watch if you haven't seen it before.
Yes.
Okay. I would say you've seen The Big Lebowski, haven't you?
I've seen The Big Lebowski.
Okay. I would say then The Game.
The Game? I haven't. Yeah. Who's that by?
So it's with Michael Douglas. Okay. Sean Penn. Mm. Okay. It's a real head trip.
Okay. Interesting choice.
Yeah. Okay.
My choice, and I'm curious, you might not have seen this. This is a bit more my generation, and it's a bit of a left field choice. But
I've got my pen at the ready.
I think it's a great one. I'm going to write it down for you.
Okay, cool. This is fun.
Have you seen Scott Pilgrim versus the World?
I've seen bits of it.
It's got
years and years ago.
It's got what's his name?
Forgotten the actor's name.
Michael Cera.
That's it.
And a few, yeah. And it's got, it's one of the first films, in fact, that, oh God, what's her name? Oh, this, it's got a really, oh, it's got Chris Evans in it, who plays, before he played Captain America.
DJ?
No, no, Chris Evans played Captain America.
Yeah, no, I don't even.
Who else? It's got a really big cast. Should have looked this up.
I'm sure you've mentioned this film before, you know.
Yeah, it's one of my favorite things, and they've just released the animated series that's played
have
that.
They?
So you've got so it's got Michael Cera, Audrey Plaza.
Don't know who that is.
You will know who Audrey Plaza is. Chris Evans, Brie Larson.
Not the DJ. Yeah, Brie Larson. I know Brie Larson.
Yeah. Who else? Oh God, I can't.
I'm googling Audrey Plaza.
You know, you'll know who Audrey Plaza is.
Oh,
Jason
yeah.
Schwartzman. And Kieran Culkin.
Jason Schwartzman.
So, yes.
Okay.
Oh, okay. Brandon Routh, that's it. Played Superman.
Yes.
And okay. Anna Kendrick. That's it, Anna Kendrick. It's one of the early films of Anna Kendrick. So, it's got a stacked cast when you look at it.
That is a strong cast.
It's a very strong cast.
Okay.
But, yes.
Oh, yeah,
one of my favourite films.
Nice.
So yeah, okay. Really, really recommend.
I'll get on that.
There you go. We'll do a catch-up podcast, I think, just of all the stuff that we missed. So like,
cool.
The cooking challenges from Laura, the cooking challenges from Hooper. So our February could be quite busy. He says I'm about to go for surgery in 3 weeks. So
Are you sure the timing of this is good?
I might have 2 weeks of like, well, I don't know how often long I've been signed off, so.
You said 2 weeks. You said 2 weeks.
I don't know. They've not mentioned it. I'm going to find out at my appointment in...
They might say 2 days. Well,
in 2 hours' time.
It's technically a pre-op, isn't it?
Today's a pre-assessment.
What are you going for? Today's a pre-assessment.
Yes. It's to basically do all the blood tests and go, can we give you a general anaesthetic? Yes. Yeah. Are you going to die? There's about, you know, there was a 0.1 chance or whatever it is.
You don't want to read the small print. The amount of times I've signed a paperwork, but I made the mistake of reading through it going,
It's fine.
Yeah.
It's all fine.
Yeah. It's all good.
The last topical event of today's podcast, 2 hours and five so far. We can talk about this for a while. We can talk about this a little bit, but I think it's really important. And I'm going to set the scene, but I'm going to call it just as it is. It's the end. I actually think we need to rename it because I think officially it's now the end of the Winchester.
Ooh, no, I would argue that it isn't. No. No. I think it's the end of an era of two people hosting the Winchester.
Okay, we could keep it to Winchester.
And, yeah, and I think that was what I was saying to chat Stevie T, is I want the Winchester to live on.
Okay.
But it lives on in a different... With different people looking after it, and it might look and feel a bit different, but it'll still be the Winchester. Oh, I'm stretching. I'm trying not to slouch. So what I'm doing, actually, you can't really see. I don't know if you can see it, but what I'm doing is I'm crossing my arms behind my back to deliberately push my shoulders back.
Yeah, he's just kind of doing that.
Yeah, I'm doing that deliberately to try and because otherwise, if I don't. What'll happen is I sit like that, and then...
Well, now I can feel, like, complete tangent, but I can feel, like, the muscles on the front of my shoulder. I don't stretch these enough.
Yeah, exactly. I don't either.
The way you do it, actually, is if you do that, and then you hold your elbows...
Yeah, that's exactly what I'm doing. Look.
I can't get up because the green screen's too close, but I'll fall over.
That's exactly what... So pretty much most of the podcasts I've been doing that, I've been holding my elbows.
Yeah, I've just doing it now.
Feel the burn.
My right shoulder apparently is mashed up, but this is my problem that I do too much exercise. And Taekwondo's a lot of push. Anyway, that was a complete tangent.
Well, I damaged my right shoulder. I damaged my right shoulder in Aikido. I couldn't do this for years. That was when I dislocated it. Anyway,
so it's not the end of the Winchester. It's the end of an era.
No, end of an era for the Winchester. Well, it's an end of an era for two people presenting it. Yeah,
yes.
But the Winchester does live on.
Yeah, and for that, for those, I don't know, the two people that presented it was the wonderful Chat Stevie T and yourself.
Chat Stevie
have been our quiz quiz hosts for, is it 118?
118 quizzes.
118
quizzes. And by the way, that excludes some of the ad hoc ones that we did. So we hosted a quiz for the
London.
Team that we... Yeah, we did one in London. Mm-hmm. We hosted a quiz for the team, one of the big product teams. Mm-hmm. Did that the other week. We hosted a quiz for another team, a program manager, a couple of years ago said, are you okay to host a quiz for us? And there's a lot of
I'll have to beep that. 2-1 Dom,
oh
2-1.
My god.
Yes.
Well, wait one second, does that count? Because I didn't say
well, that says it now, doesn't it?
Ah. Oh. Oh, for flip sakes. Yeah, do you know what? Okay, but that's a 2-1 for both.
Yeah.
I'm not going to say them again.
It's not a 3-1. It's only a 2-1.
It's not a Kinder Surprise. It's a 2-1. Oh, for flip sakes. Totally copped.
That was I've scored, like, you know, the own goal has gone in, and then in rage, you punch the ball. It's hit the post and it's hit you in the face.
It has. Oh, my God. I can't believe I just said that. Yeah. Thanks, Tom. It was bound to happen at some point. It was, yes, wasn't it, to be fair?
2-1
Bloody hell. Ah! Right.
Yes, yes, you hosted anyway, a lot of quizzes.
Yes, so we hosted. So those are excluding the ad hoc ones we've done. Oh, even the one that we did. Do you remember with, we had the CTO?
Yes.
And all the seat, right? So that excludes that one. So all in all, done about 100 and I'd say about 125 quizzes.
Yeah. Oh, that was very teenage. Yeah.
Yeah.
apparently I'm going back through puberty. Yes, absolutely. 100%. Yeah, you've done a lot of quizzes. And you've had to put each one together during the pandemic it was weekly, wasn't it?
It was weekly for I think it was weekly for over 2 years. Is that right? Yeah, it was weekly for over 2 years.
It felt weird. Like pandemic felt weird. So it was a time scale.
It was a time warp. Yeah, it was a whole weird thing going on there.
Let's
but
do the time warp again.
But
I
also,
don't know what that's from. What's that from?
That's from Rocky Horror.
Is it?
Yeah. And you jump to the left. No, I can't. I'm not even going to try and sing that.
Time
no, I'm not even going to.
Yes, it is the Rocky Horror.
Yeah, it's Rocky Horror Picture Show.
Why do I know that? I've not seen Rocky Horror.
You must have seen Rocky Horror Picture Show.
I don't.
God,
think
I saw it years ago.
I don't think I have.
With Tim Curry.
Tim Curry. The reason why this quiz, I suppose, is relevant and why we're going to talk about it is because it is the origins of the Distinct and Jovial podcast.
It is indeed, and in fact. Sorry, just one thing on the quiz. Here's a fun fact. So when people go, oh, right, 100 and... On the grand scheme of things, over a period of 4 years, doing 125 quizzes doesn't sound like a lot. Mm. Actually, Chat Stevie T and I... Well, let's take the... Well, yeah, because some of those we also had to start from scratch. So to put this into context, we had to find fresh content and material for those quizzes to cover 6 rounds... Mm. Per quiz, 10 minutes per, so enough questions to keep everyone going 10 minutes per round, plus what we'd call a Brucey bonus.
Get on Brucey, so we'd have bonus.
Yeah, so we'd have extra questions in the Brucey, and we did that for every quiz.
Mm. Yes, absolutely, and it is so, like so. You know, it's a massive undertaking, and the amount of times that I'd speak to you or Chat Stevie T at, like, on a Thursday going, I haven't written the quiz yet.
Honestly, the moments of panic, like I'll take Larry out for his constitutional on a Wednesday evening and go, oh my God, the quiz. It would come round so quickly. Like, yeah. you'd finish the quiz on a Friday afternoon and we'd go off and have our weekends, albeit during lockdown you couldn't do very much anyway. And everything was a bit weird. It was a bit of a time warp. And then you go back to work and then you think, okay, it's cool. And then you get back into the rhythm of everything during the work week. And then all of a sudden you'd have a moment of, oh my God, I've got to come up with 3 rounds in a Brucey. Mm. And Steve would be the same. Got to come up with 3 rounds. What?
fringe.
Yeah, it's like, oh my God. Which is why we came up with some of those really bizarre rounds, trying to be as creative as possible. So came up with the, you know, like Trump tweet versus Kanye tweet. And things like that. So to some of the quiz rounds that really did not work at all. And I got slated for. Steve got slated for.
Yeah. The Trump versus Kanye tweet, basically there was, this was back when it was called Twitter, they put in, must have been like 15 or something.
Something like that, yeah.
Something like that, like, and it just tweets, and it was like, who wrote this, Trump or Kanye? And honestly, it was like, what? Like, because they're both completely deranged lunatics at the moment, especially at the moment, and you think, either one of them could have written this.
Yeah.
There were a couple that you were like, well, you can tell that that's that because of the context. You know, he's talking about music, or he's talking about, you know, the prostitute that he slept with. So, you know, that's Trump. That's a Kanye. But the rest of them, you were like, did we do, there was two of those, wasn't there? Was there another one? Which was like
We did Musk, yeah. Musk versus Bezos. That yes. was no better. Got no, slated for that too. Then Steve did a MotoGP round, which is hilarious.
Yeah, MotoGP riders.
MotoGP riders with their helmets on.
With their helmets
on. On the bikes.
On the bikes.
Yeah. And they're going, I don't know. That looks no different. That Aprilia looks no different from that Aprilia. And I can't remember who's got that number. I don't know.
Well, the only person I think that watches MotoGP out of all of us on the quiz is Steve.
Well, who watches it as religiously. I was really into it one time. If you could go like, you know, if it's someone like Valentino Rossi, you just go, Rossi. Okay, that's easy. But anyone else, you know, Mark Marquez or whatever, you're like, I don't know.
Mark Marquez I could have known, but yeah.
Yeah, like, true.
You know, like the big ones, so like Valentino Rossi, you know, it's pretty obvious when you've got the bright yellow 46 on the bike, right? It's fairly
easy. Yeah, with
the
picture of the doctor, yeah.
Yeah, exactly.
But you could get somebody like, I don't know, I'm just having a look now.
Mark Marquez is always, you know, 93, so again, you knew about him. But
yeah.
Yeah.
But you've got somebody like, I don't know, Fabio Di Gianantonio.
Yeah, well, they're trying to spell the sodding thing.
I know, exactly. Di Gianantonio. Not even easy to say. Like, how would you recognise him? What the hell? Like,
the fringe.
What the fringe?
Yeah.
That's so funny. That was so funny.
I'm sure there was an American football one. I've written down.
There was an American football one. There was an American football. But some people loved that because...
Someone got all of them, didn't they?
Yeah, they did. Because we had about two or three... real American, you know, NFL fans, American football fans on the. So at least that was something, because at least you had somebody going, oh, thank you, that was brilliant. You know, we knew all of them. But the MotoGP was like stunned silence. Everyone was going, silent. Yeah, thanks, Steve. Really thanks. Appreciate it. Who the hell? You always get our favourite Australian. She went, because she doesn't hold back. Yeah. Who the hell came up with that round?
yeah, she doesn't.
What the hell are you thinking of?
If there's anybody that's going to tell you what the...
yeah, like, what?
It was our lovely, lovely Australian.
Why would you do that, you idiots? It's like, yeah, that wasn't me. That was Steve.
I mean, yeah, as I said, it was a podcast origins because that's how me and you...
It was.
The friendship,
it was.
And then...
Yeah, because we used to dial in.
Catch-ups. Yeah.
Didn't we? We used to dial in. So I used to dial in. Steve and I would dial in to host it, but you would also dial in, and then your team would always stay on that call.
Yeah. So
and that's where we got to know one another.
Yeah.
Like, really
Well, I think that's because... So basically, I didn't join a team for the first quiz. I just joined the thing because I was like, I don't usually enjoy quizzes. Okay. So I can now tell you the true origins of how I ended up. So I didn't join any team. I just was like, I'll just join the quiz host, whoever's going to be the quiz host, and just have some drinks, because that's how it started.
And then
when you were regular, I would normally be the one that'd be setting up, because I was still in my old job role while I had like two meetings a week, which meant that I had, you know, like 5-2, I'd go, I'll create the meeting, and then you'd dial into that one.
You created it. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
And then eventually I decided, well, I'll do it on my own and just see how I do. Right, and I think I got absolutely mashed right on that one.
You
I
hated
must have been
dingbats.
Like, at this point, I definitely hated dingbats.
Yeah.
but in you know, I was always with the quiz masters, on their call and bits and pieces like that, which meant, you know, we got talking and then we set up social chats, and then it was like, then it was the infamous, oh, if I was going to do a podcast, I'd love to just do it with you, Jerry. And then 2 weeks later, well, I've bought a mic. When are we starting?
Yeah, that's mad, isn't it?
So Distinct and Jovial is Jerry's fault.
You always say that. It isn't. True. Well, if you hadn't mentioned podcasts, I wouldn't have got a mic. So it's technically your fault. This isn't invented versus discovered here, right?
I made the discovery. You invented it.
Oh, I like it. Yeah, we'll stick to that then. I like that. That's how it came about.
And then some of the other highlights, I had like home improv and the music rounds. So good.
So home improv, for those who don't know, is Steve and I enacting scenes from films. So we have the script of that scene in front of us, and then we play the part of each character.
Yeah.
And we take it in turns as well.
We always did it twice. So they went through all 10, swapped, and they'd also and then go through 10 again, but they'd swap characters. So you get Jerry reading from a script and Steve trying his best at different accents for different characters. On some he, I was like, oh, do you know what? Actually, it was pretty
some he
good.
Nailed it.
Others, you were like, what the?
Yeah, well, I know. Some he nailed it, though.
Yeah, complete butchery.
Mostly butchery. Definitely on my part. And then music round was, brilliant, because Steve tried so many different things with that, which was he did intros, like classic intros, long intros. What was it? Like synth. Guitar solo, synth, that's it.
Yeah, guitar solos, bits and pieces like that. I really enjoyed the music ones, but that's because me and Steve have a very similar music taste, so I nailed it quite often.
So it was good whilst it lasted, and then Steve realised quite quickly, because every time I suggested songs, he was like, oh, I don't know. And then he'd have the list and go, yeah, Steve, that list is very you. There's like no very, like, you want to mix it. It might even be a song you hate. It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
Just put it in there because, you know.
Yeah. No, it's all good. What else? Then we've got the infamous shrimp.
And how did that come about? See, there's a story for everything. So
I can't remember how that came about.
Yeah, we did it was a food anagram round.
Oh, right, yes.
And it was famous or classic dishes or something. It was anagrams of the classic dishes. And said person, every single one was going, is number 2 shrimp? Like, no, there's about 15 letters in it. Okay. Is number 7 shrimp? Like, no. And it literally went about 4 or 5 times. So, okay, 12? It's got to have shrimp in it. No. There's no shrimp. Why? You're obsessed with shrimp. He said, I love shrimp. So then we'd have like shrimp, little pictures of shrimp. And every time he attended the quiz, I'd make a point of copying and pasting a little picture of a shrimp into the quiz. Mm. Yeah.
Or even when he's not, he hasn't been there.
Even when it's,
got to throw back to a shrimp every now and then. Yeah. But yes, it's so good. What else have I got? Home improv. I've got to mention the dimbacks just to plug
do it, because you have to, Dom, because your journey, Dingbat's journey, is epic to the point of I've never witnessed anything like it, to be honest.
Yeah, it's like, so Dingbats, you're going to have to Google those if you don't know what Dingbats are, but they're like catchphrase, aren't they?
Yes.
So you'll see a picture and you've got to try and get a phrase from it. You don't have to reveal the tiles individually, but the whole thing will be there.
Trying to think of an example, Dom.
Yeah. You know, one that you can be easily described, I suppose, is a good one.
We've done so many.
Oh,
I'm trying to think of an example. It's just really embarrassing. Yeah. We've done so many dingbats.
I should have done that. Here's one I prepared earlier.
I'm having a look at one. I'm having a look now. It's embarrassing. Yeah. It's taking forever. Okay, so here we go. So, for example, you can have a box and literally filling up that word. Filling up that box in massive letters is the word wig. So the answer to that would be big wig.
Yeah.
For example.
Yeah. Or, you know, another one I've got is you've got a lion and then a crown. Lion King.
Yes, Lion King, exactly.
Something like
that,
you know.
Or a five at the top of the box, that's high five.
Yeah. Or you might get, like, somebody falling through the sky and it'd be like, Skyfall.
Exactly.
Then you've got, like, a picture of 2 feet with smileys on it, so happy feet.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, but you've got to, Dom, you've got to talk everyone through your dingbats.
When these started, I just didn't get them, right? I was like, what the fringe are these things? Like, and there's still the odd one that you think that's a bit tenuous, right? If I'm honest, there's a stretch. But I just got them. Like, the constant from Stevie T was, don't overthink it. Just say what it is. And eventually I was like, oh, I get that. Like, the Lion King one would have stumped me for ages, but now I'm like, Lion King.
Oh, you. Yeah. So can
Lion
I just
crown,
so,
Lion King?
Can I just say so? Because I've got to sing your praises on this one. Literally for months when we initially started doing all the dingbats, and we started doing dingbats quite early. It used to be you.
Remember, I'm on the call with the quizmaster.
Yeah, you're on the call with us.
When they presented when they posted the picture of the thing, they could hear me go, "Ah, oh, for fuck's sake!"
But it wasn't just you, because it was also Shrimp Person. Used to be on the call.
Yeah,
in unison, you'd both go, "Oh, for fuck's sake! For fuck's sake! Not! Oh, for really? We're doing this again?" It's like, yeah, I've got hundreds of these. I hate to tell you, Dom, but dingbats is going to become a thing.
Yeah. So, and I just learned how to do them.
Oh, and then I don't know what happened. One day you just, I don't even recall like when it changed, but it's weird. It clicked all of a sudden and you're like, yeah, number one is this. Number two is this. Cause you type as well, don't you? So you're like, yeah, no, I already know number three. You don't even bother looking at number four. I know number four. And it's like, before you know it. So bear in mind, they're 10-minute rounds. You'd have most of them, if not all of them, within about 3 minutes.
Oh, incredible. Like, yeah. I just got quicker and quicker and just like, oh, this is a thing. Oh, I get it. I'm with you now. Yeah. Yeah.
You smash it out of the park, Dom.
My meteoric rise to dingback stardom.
Well, I have to say,
I'm now retired.
Well, wait one second. Maybe you could monetize this, because maybe there's like international dingbats competitions or something. Because if there is, you definitely need. You said you're moving away from one competition. You want to go on to another competition. Forget Taekwondo. You want to go to dingbats.
No.
Become the Grand Master of dingbats.
The Grand Master of dingbats. The bats of ding. Here we go.
Love it.
Yeah, and I'm the last thing I wrote is, you know, the team, you know, I did it on my own to begin with, but then I just got picked up the stragglers, as I called them, so people that would come occasionally, not every week. So we had the good old Dom Perignons. Dom Perignons, which I can reveal. The other two teams I can't reveal because they're, well, one of them I can, but the other one is too close to where we work, so.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, unfortunately. Yeah. But yes, my team quite often came third of the three teams. Most bronze places, but
it was for bronze.
It was the go-to. I do remember. We do hold the record though. We have the longest winning streak. We did go five sessions in a row, smashing it, and that's purely because of the music and the dingbats rounds in those five. And not losing too much on the other. The other two teams have always quite often swapped. I don't think any of them have had a long streak.
No, that's true.
And then every now and then we pop up and just go, oh, yeah, we nailed it this month.
And interesting enough, Shrimp Person as well, he used to get really frustrated because he got so used to getting bronze. It used to upset him if he got silver or gold.
He'd upset him.
So, I don't want to come first.
The tiebreaker questions as well.
Yeah. Yes.
My favourite one was the speed of... what was it? Something to do with like the speed of... going around the earth or something like that, how long it would take to go around the earth. If you were traveling at the speed of sound or something like that. It was just something I knew. And I was like, oh no, it's this. I said, the only thing I've got to do is I know it in this... I know in per second, yes, and you needed it in per minute
that.
Or something.
Yes,
and I was like, oh, it's this. And you went, you got the answer. I said, I knew the answer. And yeah, the other team was like miles off. I can't remember what one it was. But yes, that was one of the gold medals.
I was gobsmacked because you were like, I know this. I'm thinking, what the hell? How would anyone know this? It's ridiculous. It's the whole point of the tiebreaker is everyone's got to just have a wild guess. And,
yeah.
Or calculated guess anyway. But you were like, no, I actually know the answer.
I actually know the answer. I did have to do some calculation because I think you wanted it in like meters per second and I knew it in like feet per second or something. So I think
that's right.
But
yeah.
Otherwise, I was like, no, I know what this is.
No way. Unbelievable. I've forgotten. Yeah. God damn, I'd forgotten about that. That's hilarious.
Yeah. So yeah, I mean, that's... But you have stepped down.
Yes, and it's interesting because I think, you know, if we'd done the quiz for 6 months and stepped down, I think I definitely would have felt guilty. I do think we naturally got to the point of just reflecting on just how much we've done and how incredible it's been just to have everybody join. Because it's not down to Steve and I. Everyone's done it. Everyone's made the effort. It's a collective effort, right? Everybody dialed in and got together. And the fact that we've been keeping that going for 4 years and it's going to still carry on, I think is amazing, really. The power of people coming together. And I think there's a lesson to be learned here from anyone that wants to look at this, I don't know, from either a work or a sport or whatever perspective. If people want to do something, it can be a really powerful thing. If you create the right environment and make something fun for people, and then people go, yeah, this is really nice, I want to do this, then there's nothing that beats that. Because nobody has put any pressure on anybody to join that for 4 years. You have joined the Winchester for four, pretty much every, you know, there's maybe been the odd occasion, right? With everybody, even the some I couldn't
make. I don't
think
I've missed a monthly one. I think I missed the odd weekly one.
Yeah.
For holiday. But I don't think, when it switched to monthly, I don't think I've missed one.
We've had the same group of people, exactly. So we've had the same group of people.
I did one from Newcastle while I was on holiday.
Yes, you did. You've done one from your parents' place a couple of times, right?
Yeah.
So you think about that. Incredible. 4 years. No pressure. Mm. And nobody said, oh, you have to do this, or it'd be really nice if you did this. Or just everybody turned up. At that point, week in, week out, then month in, month out, and everyone's just done it off their own back because it's been so much fun. I love that. I love the power of that.
Yeah. But you two have stepped back as quiz masters.
We have.
So we're going to have some alternate quiz masters coming in. We're not the same one. It's going to be different people.
Yeah,
going to do different ones. We'll see how long that lasts in terms of, like, we may have somebody have to do a couple or something like that.
Yeah.
I will throw my hat in the ring at some point. I've got
Do it.
I've got a big plan. If I was going to do it, I'd only do it once, just once.
Okay.
But it would be, I would do it properly. It'd be hashtag spectacular. So I've got some.
Oh, plans. Dom, you have to do it. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
But I'm not going to reveal anything.
No, you can't. That's the golden rule of it. You do not even want a hint. So don't even hint at anything to Steve and I, just because we're now going to be joining, but as, you know, on the other side of the fence, so we're going to be answering questions. So
Yeah.
No spoilers.
Need to figure that out.
Yeah.
So yeah, it's going to be good. I'm excited. So
nice.
Yes. Although I'm a little bit worried because I spoke to one of the quiz masters on Friday, and her husband has already said, "Oh, that's quite a difficult round." So.
Okay. Oh, I know who you mean as well.
Yeah.
Yes. Okay. Oh, that'll be interesting. Yeah. Right.
So, we're good. We've come to the end.
Well, not quite.
Oh, we've got two last bits.
Oh, yeah. Go on.
Celebrity Call Out Corner. Go.
Yeah, that's the one. Okay. We're going to do the music, though.
Oh, I'll put the music in post edit.
Fine. Here we go. So, I'll just go Celebrity Call Out Corner.
And I'll mute you and put something else on top.
Yeah,
I didn't think I did it last time. If I get time, I'll do it. But yeah.
Okay. So this time, this is an interesting one. Not so obvious, but I think we would have such a laugh if he was on the show. So I'm calling out. So anybody that happens to know him or knows somebody that knows him, or if you're the agent, listening or somebody happens to know the agent, we'd love to have this person on the show. And it's Simon Pegg.
Oh, yes.
Right?
I think it'd be right? Right laugh.
I think we would be in hysterics. And I think
because he'd be up for it. He's the perfect person to not do an because none of our guests, we've really never really interviewed our guests apart from Yevgeny and a little bit of Swanee, but they've been conversations.
Yeah.
And I don't think I'd want to interview Simon Pegg. I'd be like, I've got these poignant questions. What's your opinion on these poignant questions?
Yeah.
What's your opinion on wearing double denim?
Yeah, absolutely.
That'd be great.
Although I must admit, questions like that, you'd have to ask the likes of Johnny Depp, for example. You know, you'd have to ask him like the most random stuff. Like,
yeah, opinions on
your favorite Greg's food item and things like that. But Simon Pegg, I'd love to have him on the show.
Yes. Oh, yes. Absolutely. God, so good. Well, now it's the bit that you always forget.
Yeah, I know. And I've forgotten thoughts. Again. Oh my God. My final thought is, why do I keep forgetting final thoughts? final thoughts. Okay, this is quite poignant. So don't, despite everything that life throws at you and how difficult things are, don't shy away from doing the things that make you happy. Mm. So it won't be in this section because Dom and I were talking about it before, but I said you're not in a good headspace at the moment. I was really not sure how I was going to get through, but you know, I've always thought, well, the show goes on and then we start, you know, once we're rolling, that's it. And it's been brilliant and I've had so much fun. It's been escapism for how long has it been? 2 hours?
Two hours thirty.
And I've loved it. So thank you very much.
It's going to be perfectly timed as well for you to take Larry for his constitution.
Yeah, there you go. And Taco Bell.
And Taco Bell, yeah, indeed. And it's interesting because that's exactly what my final thought was going to ask.
Was it? I was going to ask.
It was going to be a question. It was like, do you feel better for doing the podcast?
Oh,
you
know, 100%.
And it's one of those things where, like, we always go, oh, I don't feel like doing things. We're feeling machine. We're not thinking machines that feel. We're feeling machines that just so happen to think. There are a few of us on this planet that don't think whatsoever and could do with doing a bit of thinking, but that's a different problem. Do you feel better for having done something?
Yes.
Absolutely. Obviously, there's some, you know, if somebody said to me, right, you're going to run the marathon, but I've got the flu, I'd be like, probably not a good idea. But
yeah.
Absolutely. Right. If somebody just goes, oh, you just don't feel like going to the gym, it will make you feel better by doing it. So, yes. What a great final thought in an absolute hodgepodge of everything drawer podcast.
It's been great.
What makes us distinct and jovial.
Absolutely.
So I think we'll leave it there. Thank you very much, everybody, for watching, for listening. Thank you for your comments to our new subscribers. That's so good. I've not looked at the Spotify statistics to see if some of that's translated to that. Do leave us comments because we do read them. I read them definitely because I've got the admin rights, but I can read them out on the podcast or I can share them with Jerry in other bits. So do read them. Do send stuff to us in WhatsApp if you know us. We love it. I'm going to end with one statement and I'm going to say goodbye. To everyone that made it this far, you've all lost the game. Have a wonderful month and we'll catch you on the next podcast.
Bye.